The 1999 NASCAR Winston Cup season is down to its final 7 races. Bright sunshine and more than 81,000 fans are here at NASCAR's oldest facility, Martinsville Speedway in Virginia, as the drama for the championship continues. But this weekend, there has been as much focus off the racetrack as on the racetrack.
For the first time since May of 1992, Ray Evernham will not call the shots from atop this pit box of the Hendrick Motorsports car number 24. Never in the modern era of motorsports has so much attention been paid to the separation of a driver and crew chief. But this one is special. You see, when historians describe the Evernham era, they'll use terms like meticulous preparation, flawless execution, and total domination. From the moment they met, the marriage was magical. Ray Evernham and Jeff Gordon grabbed a Winston Cup Rookie of the Year title in 1993, serving notice of what was yet to come. But the real fireworks wouldn't begin until this emotional first victory lane at Charlotte in May of 94, which steamrolled them toward the 95 season and their first Winston Cup title. The 97 Daytona 500 was no match for Evernham's Warriors and a driver nicknamed Wonder Boy, who later wandered through this final Winston Million celebration on his way to a second NASCAR title. But 1998 would be the year that Ray's rallying cry, "Refused to lose," took on special meaning. Nothing, not the Brickyard nor a million-dollar bonus, would escape their grasp en route to a record-setting 13-win, $9 million season, and third Winston Cup title. If Ray Evernham were here today, he would be the first to tell you that no man is an island. No one individual is the key. It's all about teamwork, commitment, and communication, all of which his disciple and now descendant, Brian Weitzel, understands. Now, as for Brian, there is tremendous pressure, but also tremendous pride. Pride that he has the total support of his car owner, Rick Hendrick. Pride that he has the total confidence of his driver, Jeff Gordon. And pride that he was trained and prepared for this day by the very best, one Ray Evernham.
So all the rumors and the speculation that we've wondered about for the last couple of weeks are true. Ray Evernham is gone. And I think one question that a lot of race fans are asking today, Ned, is why has he abandoned the team with just 7 races to go this year?
Bobby, it had become a major distraction for not only Ray Evernham, but the entire 24 team. They didn't need that at this point of the season. It also gives him an opportunity to go away and do whatever it is that he's going to do. And Brian Weitzel coming on as the crew chief for Jeff Gordon, it'll give them an opportunity to work directly together for these last 7 races of 1999, which can prepare them better for the year 2000.
That's exactly right. And I think all teams have got to figure they're not going to win the championship in 1999. That's Dale Jarrett's championship to win. So they might as well get ready for the year 2000, just like Mark Martin did last week at Dover. They haven't been as competitive in 1999 as they were in 1998. So they said, let's start over. Let's go back to 1998 and see where we've gone astray. Guess what? They take a 98 car to Dover. They win the race. Now they're better prepared for the year 2000 than they were last week.
Well, Dale Jarrett continues to occupy the points lead as he has since Richmond in May. Several positions are close within the top 10. And, of course, the top 10 will be on the stage at the Waldorf. Now, their starting positions are spread today throughout the field from 5th all the way back to 38th.
With only 7 races left in the season, all sights are set on Dale Jarrett in the chase for the Winston Cup. But the battle for second has taken center stage as only 154 points separate second through fifth. Mark Martin propelled himself back into second place in the chase last week by winning at Dover Downs. A third place finish has DJ smiling at the thought of a postseason celebration. But before the party starts for the other guys, the competition will get furious. Martin, Labonte, Stewart, and Burton have combined to win 12 races this year. Rookie sensation Tony Stewart really has his work cut out for him today if he hopes to extend his win total here in 1999. In the spring, Tony started from the pole position, but on Friday, he could not find the handle on the racetrack. And as a result, he starts 37th today. Although his team found a lot more speed in happy hour and wound up in the top 10. In the last 3 races, Tony has finished no worse than second. That streak could come to an end today unless Tony comes through with a gutsy performance. And speaking of gutsy performance, who can forget last year's heroic effort by Ricky Rudd?
Temperature expected near 90 or perhaps a couple of degrees over that.
This is going to be the one of the hardest races anybody's ever driven.
Ricky Rudd, the Tide Rod, is a really good race car today.
Explain what's going on inside the tent car. The cooling unit in the helmet has frozen up. He is basically inside that helmet, suffering. The heat is almost unbearable. They poured water on his back in the seat to try to cool him off. He heats up and becomes a sauna. His backside and bottom are burning.
Incredible story of courage and stamina.
Ricky Rudd wins the NAPA AutoCare 500.
Ricky Rudd had his day in the sun last September, beating the heat and beating the field. Now, standing face-to-face with a new seat of the near future, Rudd wants to take a little piece of his past with him by winning at least one race for the 17th straight season. But for the last two seasons, the short track wars have been a combination of strength and surprise. 11 different winners in the last 11 short track races. Is it parity or newfound power? Today, another short track and another look at the big picture and the longtime racing link that bonds the unexpected, the experienced, and the inevitable. So what are the expectations for this afternoon? Could we see another fresh face finish at the front of the field and stretch the short track streak to 12? How about one of these guys starting in the top four? After all, 51% of all Winston Cup races at Martinsville have been won by a driver starting fourth or better. But listen to this. The top four qualifiers for this race have posted exactly one win in their last 690 combined starts. And that win came 2 weeks ago when Joe Nemechek won at New Hampshire. You might think some of the guys in this field have been in the witness protection program, when in fact the only thing they've been guilty of is breaking our hearts. Today, they hope to break in to victory lane.
With the engine started, can Gordon win without Evernham? Can Jarrett add to his points lead? Will there be a 12th different short track winner? Just some of the stories will follow this afternoon. ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports, and the National Association for Stock Car Auto Racing, NASCAR, welcome you live to Martinsville Speedway in Virginia for the NAPA AutoCare 500, the 28th race of the 1999 NASCAR Winston Cup season. The cars are poised to get ready to go. We'll go 500 laps here this afternoon, 263 miles. The purse is almost $2 million. And without a caution, they should be able to go up to 165 laps without a fuel stop. The race record is held by Jeff Gordon. That was set this race back in 1996. Well, let's take a look at the Everstart Walmart grid, and you're going to see some interesting names up at the top. Joe Nemechek has his second pole of 1999. He also won the pole for the Pepsi 400 at Daytona in July. And Ted Musgrave has his best start of 1999. Jeffrey Bodine is no stranger to this racetrack. He has four wins at this facility. Kyle Petty finished 10th here in the spring. Jeff Gordon qualified fifth in his first run without Ray Evernham. Mark Martin recorded his second win of 1999 just last week. Kenny Wallace, the pole winner in the spring of 97, has the seventh starting position. And Ricky Rudd, the defending winner of this race, starts in the eighth position. Back in the fifth row, John Andretti, who won this race here in the spring, and Rich Bickle, who recorded his career best finish in this race last year when he came home fourth. Now, as we take a look at the rest of the starting lineup, boy, it sure is a different day weather-wise today than it was a year ago. Remember when the heat was above 90 degrees, but Ned, today a kind of a cool and pleasant day.
It's the kind of a day that the crews and the drivers in particular hoped that they would have when they came to Martinsville in 1999. Yeah, it's much better for them in the race car and on pit road.
And so, Benny, as we take a look back through this starting lineup, a lot of times we talk about how some of these guys in the middle, the back of the field, are at a disadvantage because there are two sets of pits, but not here. But boy, the pits run all the way from turn three around to turn two.
Well, that's exactly what Martinsville Speedway did. They built one pit road, you enter up in turn three, and you come out of the pits in turn two. And it takes forever around that long pit road at about 30 miles per hour. Next, see Hut Strickland and Kevin LePage, the last car to get in on qualifying. And there are provisionals. How about these two guys back in the 18th, 19th row, Stewart and Earnhardt?
Tony Stewart won the pole for this race in the spring, but had to take a provisional to get into the starting lineup here for this event. Four drivers failed to qualify, including Ron Hornaday, Morgan Shepherd, Dick Trickle driving the number 41 car, and Tim Fedewa was given the assignment in the 91 machine but did not make the race. We've got 10 onboard cameras for you.
Tony Stewart starting in 37th, the Home Depot onboard camera. Bill Elliott, McDonald's onboard camera, starts in 33rd. Bobby Hamilton will be carrying the NAPA onboard camera, starting in 30th spot. Kenny Irwin has the Ribestos onboard camera, starting in 27th position. Bobby Labonte, the Circuit City onboard, in 25th. Wally Dallenbach has the Budweiser onboard camera. He starts 23rd this afternoon. Rusty Wallace, always runs so well, in 20th, the Miller Lite onboard. And Mike Bliss, the Jimmy Dean onboard camera. Ricky Rudd, Give the Kids the World, starting in 8th spot. And Mark Martin, the Babylon, starting in 6th.
We're ready for racing at Martinsville.
Still side by side. You couldn't do that here at Martinsville, run side by side for a couple of laps, but that second groove is working now. And let's see who's going to lead this lap. It's going to be Musgrave again.
And the second time that Ted has led in 1999, he led at the Trans-South Financial 400 in Darlington, but still they are side by side all the way around the racetrack.
That's pretty impressive that Ted Musgrave is able to hang on up there this early in the race. He led that lap.
I don't think Nemechek has led a lap yet. He's right there. He started on the pole, but so far it's been Musgrave coming back down the front stretch to lead each lap. And now Nemechek gets a little bit of a run on Musgrave. He will lead this lap, but Ted comes back on the outside.
Bodine right there in the third spot as Mark Martin's moved to fourth. And Kyle Petty, Jeff Gordon, Ricky Rudd, Kenny Wallace, and John Andretti. On board with Mark Martin.
Nemechek got very loose coming off turn four. He gathered it back in, and Musgrave had to back out for just a moment to keep from hitting him.
Be the position to get to spin in front of all the, because it'd only be 42 other cars coming along trying to hit you.
Now they get pretty much in single file formation all the way back to about the 21st spot. Again, we're on board with Mark Martin, who runs fourth. High above Martinsville Speedway, the Pennzoil Copper Cam has the shot as the cars come through corners three and four and on the straightaway. And you can see how much the field has strung out already. They're almost halfway around, if not a little bit more. Just about halfway around.
So right now, Jerry Nadeau running in 43rd is already a half lap behind, just in seven laps.
Rusty Wallace beginning to move back there, moving on the inside of Michael Waltrip in the car number seven. Rusty started 20th. He now is working on the 18th position.
You have to go that far back to get side-by-side racing. We're on board with Mike Bliss, who goes to the inside of Michael Waltrip and tries to gain that spot, the 19th. And he will do so. Waltrip and Michael, or rather Wally Dallenbach, also running side by side. For a taste of the race, let's check out the onboard telemetry.
This is Mike Bliss,
Winston NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series driver. And you see, look at Jeff Gordon try to go up on the outside of Mark Martin, but all he's going to do, it looks like, is lose a spot, because as he dove in on the outside, Ricky Rudd tried to go to the inside, but now, once again, Jeff is on the outside. Can't make it work. Well, now Mark is going to move up and give him some room. Jeff will continue on the outside.
This is the battle for fifth position. Rudd also trying to position himself to the outside of Mark Martin. And Rudd will take the spot away from Mark, and so will Ricky. And now there goes Kenny Wallace. There's the old dog cam, BP.
Yep. So John Andretti alongside the Valvoline Ford.
So Mark, despite the fact he's running down where most people do, is losing spots here.
Well, a couple things are happening. Once a car got up on the outside and it took the line away that he needed to get into the turn, plus the fact that Mark is not fighting the situation that much right now, and said, okay, if you guys want to run that hard this early in the race, go ahead. I'm not going to keep you from it.
Rudd takes a position away from Gordon, so move Ricky Rudd up to fifth. Now Kenny Wallace will challenge Jeff for the sixth position down the backstretch. And Wallace, he was going to be able to get the position from Jeff. And he will do so. So Joe Nemechek continues to lead with Musgrave running second. Then it's Jeffrey Bodine, Kyle Petty, and Ricky Rudd. Those are the top five with 15 of 500 laps completed. ESPN's live coverage of the NAPA AutoCare 500 from Martinsville Speedway in Virginia is being brought to you by AC Delco Automotive Parts. AC Delco, if you're not asking for it, you're asking for it. By Coca-Cola Classic, the official soft drink of NASCAR fans. And by ESPN Video, get your officially licensed NASCAR videos from ESPN Video. We've completed 23 laps. Joe Nemechek with about a one-second lead on, well, was Ted Musgrave, but now here comes Jeffrey Bodine up for the challenge inside turn two.
For many, many years, Jeffrey Bodine, this power team Chevrolet, has run so well here at the Martinsville Speedway. When he first came here in the modifieds back in the early 80s, he was the guy to beat. And then Winston Cup cars have been almost equally as good.
First win in Winston Cup competition came here at Martinsville in April of 1984. That was also the very first win for car owner Rick Hendrick. Only one top 10 finish in 1999 so far. That was the second race of the year at Rockingham, where he came home eighth.
You can see up ahead there, the shot that we had, that Joe Nemechek is beginning to catch the tail end of the field. So they're already coming up on traffic. Just went around Dave Marcus in the real tree, car number 71, made him a lap down.
We go back here to 18th and 19th position. That is Mike Bliss in the 30 car.
Smoke.
And he is smoking.
Yes, he is. A lot of smoke coming out of the back of that Jimmy Dean sausage Pontiac. As we look back at our camera, we can see the smoke, and it's much worse in the corner. So let's go on board with Mike Bliss, check out the taste of the race, see what kind of miles per hour, RPMs that he might be turning.
Yellow. Go high, go
and
high.
We do have
high.
A yellow. Kenny Irwin has spun down in turn number four, necessitating our first yellow flag of the afternoon. It comes out on lap number 30. Irwin trying to get the car off the curb and pointed in the right direction, and other cars having to move high on the racetrack to avoid hitting him.
Unfortunately, he went a lap down. Dave Marcus got his lap back.
Kenny, of course, has recorded three straight top 10 finishes in 99. He finished 10th at Dover, 10th at New Hampshire, and 5th at Richmond. It is the first to go a lap down here at Martinsville. And although Marcus did lose a lap, he got it back when the caution came out. take a look at some replays here. We're going on board with Tony Stewart. Looks like he was right behind Kenny.
This is the Home Depot onboard camera. Tony goes down in the corner. And right there, a little bump from Tony Stewart. Ooh, wow, almost in contact with Jimmy Spencer. And we'll see what... And listen to Kenny Irwin.
Doesn't take much in the corner just to send him on around. A lot of cars made pit stop during this caution, especially those back towards the tail end of the field.
We saw the smoke coming from the Jimmy Dean Pontiac. They're looking over the situation, see if they can get Mike Bliss back in the race. The boot goes down, the pins go in, and Mike will be giving chase once again. Back in a moment. Here's a look at why we are about to end our first caution. Watch Stewart and Irwin.
There we see just that little bit of bump, and watch as Kenny Irwin goes around, and it's amazing, only one car involved as all the other cars taking that evasive action. Back to green flag racing.
And that overhead replay courtesy of the Pennzoil copter cam, which is hovering overhead Martinsville Speedway and will continue to do so all afternoon long.
And Ricky Rudd goes by Kyle Petty, takes over that fourth spot, and Kenny Wallace on the outside, and he's rubbing with Kyle Petty.
Kyle didn't get off to the start that he wanted to on the restart. Now he seems to have that hot wheel rolling the way he wants it to.
Kevin LePage lost a lap when he pitted during this caution period, and more from John Kernan.
Bob, Kevin was called for pitting out of the box. The right side tires, NASCAR official says they were over the line. Pat Tryson argued, but to no avail, so he was penalized a lap. They took on right side tires, also removed the spring rubber from the right rear. To Bill Weber.
Mike Bliss in an on-the-track audition for the 30 ride. He has worked out an agreement to get out of his contract at Roush Racing. Wants to try and make the move to Winston Cup. Had a good start going, was following Rusty Wallace through the field. They had a power steering fluid hose knocked loose. That's what was causing the smoke. They brought him back in. They tightened the hose. They filled him up. He lost a couple of laps.
Indeed, he is two laps down, while Irwin and LePage are one lap down. All the other 40 cars on the lead lap. And up front, while Nemechek leads, it's a good race for second and third. Jeffrey Bodine, Ted Musgrave, and Ricky Rudd.
Jeffrey Bodine had just passed Ted Musgrave just before the caution came out, and now Musgrave is all over him, wants the position back.
We'll continue to track the points for you throughout the afternoon in our NAPA field summaries. Mike Skinner at the moment is up into the 10th position and Terry Labonte down to 11th. That's one of several good points battles that are going on throughout the top 20 in Winston Cup racing. Tony Stewart continues to move his way up through the field. He is about to take the 26th spot from Brett Bodine.
NASCAR today talks about following Dale Earnhardt through the field. Right now, Earnhardt is up in 22nd, and as you said, Stewart is now in 26th.
Just ahead, Jimmy Spencer. And his teammate, Stewart's teammate, Bobby Labonte, just up ahead.
And there's Dale Earnhardt, the Goodrich Chevrolet, as he goes by Rick Mast, and that will move him up another spot up to 21st.
John Kernan has more on Dale Earnhardt.
Dale Earnhardt has been making a charge toward the front after starting in the 38th position. They did not pit under that caution. Instead, Earnhardt made an adjustment inside the car. He made a brake bias adjustment to dial in one round more of rear brakes to help him get into the corners to help with the braking balance of the race car. But he's flying so far.
Could look at several criteria to determine the short track champion for 1999, but if you were to look at average finishes in the first five, and this is of course the sixth and last short track race of 99, Dale Earnhardt has the best average finish of 8.8.
So Wally Dallenbach going to corner, Jimmy Spencer get on the inside. Meanwhile, you're seeing Mike Skinner on the inside of the 22 car. That's about the 11th position. And then we see Ricky Rudd on the inside of Musgrave trying to take over that third spot. And I believe this tide ride is really good at this point of the race.
Seems like you said that a year ago at this time, didn't you? By the end of the race, however, Rudd was not in very good shape. Remember the heat and the fact that he was suffering from the flu, and he still drove the victory lane.
Terry Labonte is off the pace. Terry Labonte in the Kellogg's Chevrolet is definitely off the pace. He's into the pits.
Doesn't look good. And here comes Kyle Petty on the inside of Musgrave. That's for fourth position. Ted, don't look behind you, but they're all ganged up on you now. It's Kenny Wallace is going to try to follow Kyle Petty through. And right behind that, John Andretti trying to get on the inside of Jeff Gordon. This racetrack is all about position and brakes and horsepower.
Overall, the 1999 season has been a very good one for Kyle Petty. He has six top 10 finishes this year. That is four more than he had in all of 1998. And add to the fact that some of the finishes that he's had this year really don't reflect how well that he and the Hot Wheels Pontiac has run.
Kyle Petty back in the early 90s when he was absolutely
the
best.
Good job, buddy. Beat the boot now. Take care of the brake.
Good idea. When he was absolutely the best on flat racetracks. And it looks like he's getting some of that magic back again.
Bill, what's the situation with Terry Labonte?
Transmission woes, Bob. They were going to try and push the car behind the wall, but it is stuck in gear. The car will not move, so they're going to go underneath. They got a member of the Budweiser crew to help them out here to try and knock the thing out. Terry's already taken his helmet off, so this is going to be a long stop. They're going to go to the rear wheel, try and take out the axle. Terry Labonte's had problems here before, and they've been able to fix it and finish second, but he is not going to finish second here today.
Just sits there hopelessly and helplessly as the laps continue to click away. He's now five laps down, and that, of course, is going up. Joe Nemechek has a 1 1/3 second lead on Jeffrey Bodine as Terry Labonte sits on pit road. The NAPA AutoCare 500 from Martinsville, Virginia, continues in just a moment.
It's a dead heat coming out of the turn. Martin spots an opening and roars through it. Mark Martin takes it wide, very wide. He's leaving the track.
Hardee's new All-Star Bacon Cheeseburger. A big, juicy bacon cheeseburger loaded with everything. A favorite of Mark Martin of the Hardee's All-Star Racing Team.
Martin is through the gate and back on the track.
The All-Star Bacon Cheeseburger. Only at Hardee's.
57 laps completed already. A lot of things have happened. Power steer hose for Mike Bliss. A spin by Kenny Irvin as he feels the back bumper of Tony Stewart and Terry Labonte on pit road because of a rear end gear problem. Martha Nemechek cheers as her son Joe continues to lead the NAPA AutoCare 500. There's the overhead shot of this half-mile facility courtesy of the Pennzoil copter cam.
And Joe Nemechek, the leader, the Bell South Chevrolet, has caught Wally Dahlen back and a little contact off turn two as he tried to get by Dahlen back, tried to go on the inside. And so Dahlen back moves over, lets Joe Nemechek go by.
Dahlen back running in the 38th position, a little bit different paint scheme on the 25 car this weekend. They are celebrating the last World Series of the 1990s. Budweiser, not only the official beer of NASCAR, but also the official beer of Major League Baseball. That's why the baseballs encircle the numbers on Dahlenbach's car this weekend.
And Woody Woodpecker in trouble.
Yeah, Rick Mask has gone backwards, Benny. He started in 12th position. I was surprised he didn't stop during that caution that we had. But now he's going a lap down because that car is just not handling.
Now riding alongside the Budweiser Chevrolet of Wally Dahlenbach as he sees the 42 car of Nemechek put in Rick Mast a lap down. And right beside of Wally Dahlenbach will be Jeffrey Bodine, the second place car, the Power Team Chevrolet. Tony Glover, the crew chief on the 42 car, ought to be very happy about what's going on down there. Here's the Jerry Punch.
Well, Benny is, but he's not down here. Actually, how important is working traffic at Martinsville? We'll take a look at where the crew chief and team manager Tony Glover is. That is him up on top of the roof there. He is acting as Joe Nemechek's spotter today, basically talking to Joe every single lap. He is some seven stories up in the air on the top of the grandstand as a spotter. And by the way, Nemechek dominating early in this race a year ago. Sterling Marlin qualified seventh and led the most laps, only to have an electrical problem with about 30 laps to go. His crew chief that day, the same man, Tony Glover.
I've always thought that was be a good place for a crew chief to be, up where the spotters are, so they can get an overview of everything that's going on the racetrack and make it easier to make those decisions.
There's third, fourth, and fifth. Rudd, Wallace, Kenny Wallace, and the 44 of Kyle Petty. Now Wallace will try to go to the inside of Ricky Rudd and go for that third spot. There's Jeff Gordon back in sixth. As he tries to work his way around the 98 of Rick Mast.
John Andretti, and then the 31 car right behind him is Mike Skinner. Mike Skinner is in eighth place. He started back in the 16th position. Mike Skinner is coming towards the front. So is this man, Rusty Wallace. Started 20th, now in 11th.
Be any surprise to anyone watching this race that Rusty Wallace would run good at Martinsville. He always has the car up front when we come to this speedway.
There's our points leader, Dale Jarrett. He runs back in the 13th position.
After just taking that position away from Jeff Burton. Burton's car seems to be spinning a little bit right now.
Bill Weber has more on the points leader, Jarrett.
Bob, early in the race, Dale Jarrett a little loose off. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment, 1 pound down on the rear tires, and they also want to make a chassis adjustment. The one critical question Todd Bodine did ask DJ earlier in the race, how's the shock change? And Dale said, that's good. The car is driving well.
Jarrett made his first start in NASCAR Winston Cup competition in April of 1984 here at this racetrack.
Driving for Emmanuel Cervakis.
Dale Earnhardt now ready to pick up another position, trying to get around Jeremy Mayfield. This will move him up to 15th.
He's making an impressive run through the field. Started way back in 38th.
This is going to be a situation unlike Bristol. When he makes all these passes, all these cars, when he makes a pit stop, he will not lose them when he goes in the pits because they have one pit road here. His Goodrich crew.
Whoops.
Gary Irwin says, I seem like I remember that from the last time someone got behind him.
Kenny Erlin, of course, will not be in the 28 car for 19 rather for the year 2000.
And look at that yellow car of Bobby Hamilton. He started back in 30th position, and he's moving up through the pack, too, and now in 17th.
There he is. Irwin just up ahead, but Irwin is a lap down.
And Kodak Film, NAPA Auto Parts onboard camera.
Dale Earnhardt has gained 23 positions since the start of the race. Stewart, 18. Up front, oh, we have Jeffrey Bodine right there behind Joe Nemechek.
Yeah, where are they going to go? They got two cars running side by side, Chad Little and Elliott Sadler, and that's about all you can do around this racetrack is two abreast.
And Kenny Wallace also behind this group as Nemechek now gets on the inside of Elliott Sadler. Kenny Wallace wanted to go on the outside of Jeffrey. He's going to try it again on the outside. Wow.
Well, he may make it work, huh?
Wow. Kenny, I'm impressed. Good move.
Move Wallace up to second.
He loves this racetrack. Ran good here in the Busch Series. Has won a pole here and has run good in many races.
He told us on his qualifying show Friday that Martinsville was a Wallace racetrack. I thought he was talking about Rusty.
The quarters are very, very tight at Martinsville, needless to say. Stewart continuing to march toward the front of the field. He's up to 20th. Started 37th from his onboard camera. Up ahead is Jeremy Mayfield and Sterling Marlin and his teammate Bobby Labonte.
You see Bobby Hamilton up there trying to go on the outside of the 18 of Bobby Labonte, take away a spot.
Oh, Mayfield got a little rough into the corner. That allows Stewart to pull up alongside of him.
This is Knapp on board of Bobby Hamilton. As he looks back at his group, there's Hamilton, front line Sterling Marlin, and the 18 of Bobby Labonte.
Now the 75 and the 88 are battling for the 11th position, and Jarrett gets it. Dale close to the top 10 as Kenny Wallace moves to the inside of Joe Nemechek and tries for the lead. And gets the lead.
How about that? Kenny Wallace started back in seventh spot in here. 80 laps into this race has moved to the front.
Well, that is the first lap that Kenny Wallace has led in 1999. The last time he led a race was a year ago at New Hampshire.
And no one gave him that. He had to take it. It wasn't the fact that everybody pitted and he stayed out on the racetrack or anything like that. He came up and passed everybody he had to, including Joe Nemechek.
Earned it. Kenny Wallace won his first pole of his career here at Martinsville in 97, and now he is a leader here at this facility with 80 of 500 laps completed. Pennzoil Copter Cam continues to provide the overhead shots of this paperclip-shaped racetrack, the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia at Martinsville. 88 laps completed, and the leader, Kenny Wallace, is in a whole bunch of traffic.
Yes, he is. We see his teammate, Kenny Schrader, just about five cars in front of him as he tries to get by Jerry Nadeau, the M&M's car. Right now, Nadeau in 34th position.
One good thing about it, Kenny Wallace can go anywhere on the racetrack and still get good traction. He can go on the outside if he needs to, where he is right now. And if he needs to go on the inside, he can go down there, too. That's a good car to have. But right now, the car's running side by side. He can't go anywhere.
Prior to today, Wallace had only led eight laps of this at this facility. That was in April of 98. He has so far led 12 laps as he crosses the line. Here's Kyle Petty, Ricky Rudd, Jeff Gordon, and John Andretti running back in third, fourth, fifth, and sixth.
And Rudd is the car of the tied cars, the one losing the positions now as Kyle goes by and Jeff Gordon comes up to challenge. Joe Nemechek has fallen all the way back to the eighth position.
He was leading a little bit earlier, but has dropped back to eighth. Jerry, what's the problem with Joe?
The car was absolutely perfect for 75 laps, and on lap 76, he commented, it's starting to get tight in the middle and loose off over the next four or five laps. It got worse and worse. He lost the lead on lap 80. And now what Tony Glover is saying is, just slow down your entry into the corner so you can keep the car on the bottom of the racetrack, and you won't lose as many spots. Just hang out for about 30 to 40 more laps. We'll bring you down pit road, and we'll fix it. Let's check in with Bill Weber.
Ward Burton has had an overheating problem almost from the very beginning of the race. In fact, he had to back out of the throttle and out of traffic so he could force cooler air into the radiator. Last check, the water temperature had dropped. The only thing is that it only dropped to 230 degrees.
Ward currently runs in the 10th position.
And 230 degrees water temperature is just about the jumping off place. Anything above that, you stand a chance to keep going up and losing water. That's about the maximum you'd want to run.
71 car of Dave Marcus is not in this battle, but the other three are Jarrett, Earnhardt, and Marlin.
And Sterling Marlin has really been coming up through the field. He's another of those drivers. His car is hooked up. Look at him move on the inside of Earnhardt. Let's see if Marcus might be in his way there. Marcus Jarrett not able to get around him.
And Sterling Marlin and Earnhardt are both going by Jarrett.
DJ just can't run up on the high side of the racetrack, it doesn't look like. Well, maybe he's got a problem.
The right front's flat. Yes, the right front tire's flat.
Wow. Well, he's
going to bring it in, and the Martinsville bug bites Dale Jarrett early in the race. Here he comes down pit road. And it is a long, long way at 30 miles an hour down this pit road. Down to Bill Weber.
4,400 down pit road. This will take a long time. It's an all-day trip to get around this pit road. They call in that he had a flat, was coming in to go around to the right side first. Todd Parrott says we're going to change four tires. This is a track where Dale Jarrett really has a love-hate relationship. He's finished 12th or worse in five of the last seven races here. He does have two top tens in the last three races, but he has a long day and a hard battle ahead of him now. The Winston Cup points leader still crawls down pit road.
And despite the fact it only took 16.7 seconds, Jarrett is a lap down.
You know, now he just got to hope. The team has just got to hope and pray that the caution flag doesn't come out before the leaders have to make their pit stop. If that should happen, if it stays green for another 75 laps or so, then Dale Jarrett will be okay because these new tires will allow the car to run a little bit faster. And when they slow down and make their pit stops, then he should be able to get back in contention.
Now he's two laps down now. The leader is not too far out in front of him, but it's 3 or 4 seconds, and he's got a lot of cars to pass before he can get to him.
John Andretti takes the fifth position away from the man with whom we ride. That's Ricky Rudd. Jarrett right behind Rudd. And then Mike Skinner, who, as Ned pointed out earlier, has really made a move toward the front. He's up to seventh.
Spotters of these cars that Jarrett's coming up on will say he's got new tires on, let him go. He's a couple laps down. So that'll work to his advantage.
Bill, what's that tire look like?
Tire looks good, Bob. Right front off the 88 car to the valve stem. Very loose here. Broken valve stem on the right front tire. Air leaks out. It goes flat. He's got to come in, and now he's got to continue that battle. Valve stem on the right front of Dale Jarrett's car.
Wow. An unfortunate set of circumstances for Dale Jarrett chasing his first NASCAR Winston Cup championship. Just past the 100 lap mark, it's Kenny Wallace leading at Martinsville. Welcome back to Martinsville Speedway in Virginia. Kenny Wallace, the driver of the 55 Squared E car, is the leader of this NAPA AutoCare 500. About a 3 second advantage on Jeffrey Bodine, with Kyle Petty running third, followed by Jeff Gordon and John Andretti. 109 laps are completed as Wallace moves up now on the 66 of Darrell Waltrip, who's running in 27th position, trying to put him a lap down. For a taste of the race, let's jump on board and check out the Jimmy Dean sausage telemetry.
We'll see down the straightaway. Checker miles per hour up to about 115 miles per hour. Now, Dahlenbach just made a pit stop about 10 laps ago. He passed, came back on the racetrack, passed leader Kenny Wallace. And look, Jeff Burton about to go a lap down to Kenny Wallace right in front of the leader. Burton back in 25th position.
And this is a situation that can sometimes cause a caution when you run up on the leader, runs up on cars that wants to stay on the lead lap. Not that Jeff Burton would do anything wrong, but a lot of cars battling back and forth with each other trying to stay on the lead lap, and sometimes they just touch, and that can be disastrous.
So Steve Park back in the Pennzoil Chevrolet, he's in 24th. The leader's not that far. We see Dahlenbach, that red strip goes across, and there's Martin. Also, Jeff Burton's teammate has fallen back to the 23rd position, not too far in front of the leader, Kenny Wallace.
Jeff Burton, who won this race 2 years ago, is a lap down. There is Mark Martin, who's running back in 23rd position and close to being lapped. Here comes Wallace. There are Burton and Jarrett, along with the 66 of Darrell Walter. Jerry, what's wrong with the 99?
Apparently, they think they may have a tire going down, so the spotter's been trying to get him on the pit road. Now, indeed, he has made the move on the pit road, but it is a very, very long way from the north end of this racetrack all the way down to where they are pitting off of turn two at 30 miles an hour, 4,400 RPMs in second gear, and that's where his crew will wait on him to change four tires. They don't know which one it is, so Frank Stoddard has made the call. We'll go ahead and change all four. We cannot take a chance. They wait and wait for the outside forward, and now he has finally gotten here. Frankie Stoddard will dash across to change the right front. The right rear tire coming off the jack beneath the car. No chassis changes. His left side. As DJ now gets a lap back, that's pretty important for that championship point race. Garrett now has gotten one of his two left back. Left side tires off the Jeff Burton. He is down and away.
And not a great distance to go before he gets back out on the racetrack. Jeremy Mayfield is in, Bill.
116 laps on the board. He's got four tires, big chassis adjustment, a lot of trouble with the left rear tire. Lug nuts fell off. They got him back on. He's on his way. Long stop, very costly at a short track.
There is Jared, and you can see that he is ahead of Kenny Wallace, so he gets lap one of his two laps back.
And we see Martin on the lap down. Bill Weber, what's going on with Mark?
Kenny, they're getting ready to pit the sixth car. Mark Martin's car, very loose. He's been complaining about it almost from the drop of the green flag. Loose car, they should be headed down pit road.
They are headed down pit road. So is Ted Musgrave, who started from the outside of the front row and led the first three laps of this race. But now he, too, is on pit road just ahead of Mark Martin. He flanks off, and now here comes Mark to his pit box. Bill is there.
Well, this should be a lot of work for this crew. They're going to make a big chassis adjustment on the right side. Of course, we'll get four tires and a full load of fuel. They drop the wedge wrench, so that's the only chassis adjustment they're going to make. Slap on the left side tires, try and bolt those on and get Mark out as quickly as possible. His car, again, was very, very loose.
Former winner here in Martinsville in the spring of 92, Mark Martin accelerates now as he hits the racetrack.
Ken Schrader about to come into the pits. We'll see others coming in. Rick Masters in the pits now. There'll be others that'll stop shorter than they would have to as far as fuel is concerned because of loose race cars.
We'll see Schrader bringing the Skoll Chevrolet into a stop. This is a team car. And Kenny Wallace, both cars out of Andy Petrie Racing.
Jimmy Spencer has come into the pits.
We'll see the right side's coming off the Kenny Spencer automobile, and a big adjustment in the right rear.
Schrader is away. Work of being completed on Jimmy Spencer, and now he pulls away. And Jerry has an update on the 99 car. Doc?
Yeah, let me correct myself. I said they were coming and they thought they had a tire going down. What they were actually saying was four tires instead of flat tire. And the reason they pitted was because once he got lapped and had gone a lap down, they decided to go ahead and make their pit stop and work on the car rather than stay out there and lose more and more time. So that's why the pit stop, it was an early scheduled stop.
On board with Bobby Hamilton, looking back on Rich Bickle, who ran so well here a year ago, and he now is just about to get lapped by Kenny Wallace. There's Kenny.
And he gets on the inside of Bobby Hamilton, trying to take that position away. That is the 21st position now. That would put Hamilton back to 22nd. But the bigger trouble than that is Kenny Wallace, but now he goes off the pit road.
And the leader is coming in. Entering the pits in turn number three and driving all the way around to turn two. And this has got to seem like an eternity. And Kyle Petty picks up the lead as he passes Jeffrey Bodine, and Jeff Gordon takes over second. Here comes Andretti as Bill Weber will report on the pit stop.
Kenny Wallace jumped on the pit road, then jumped on the radio. What's the speed? What's the speed? 4,800 in second gear. Right side tires are on. Come around to the left. This is tires and fuel only. Notice the bright yellow lug nuts. That's so the teams can see the lugs with all the brake dust. Good stuff for the 55 to Jerry Punch.
And finally, Joe Nemechek will be able to get something done in this ailing car. Four tires, three rounds of bite to try to get this car to stick on the racetrack. They wanted to get this first pit stop under the yellow flag so they could unhook the rear sway bar. But that was not the case. Under green flag conditions, they will simply change the air pressure, put the bite in, and now put left side tires on. Our pole sitter, Joe Nemechek, had continued to fall back. And now finally, trouble with the left rear. They took the tire back off, now put it back on. And the 71 car of Marcus, slowing on the track, is pulled over.
Nemechek with a very slow pit stop comparatively, 22.3 seconds. And there is Dave Marcus. And now a battle for the second position as Andretti goes inside of Jeff Gordon. And there's a leader right there also.
How about that? Petty Enterprises running 1-2 right now. Kyle Petty the leader and John Andretti, his team car, in second spot as DW. Now goes a lap down in 20th position.
Darrell Waltrip loses another lap. He is experiencing brake problems already in this race. And Jeff Gordon now hits pit road. Remember the Rainbow Warriors under a new leader here this weekend. Brian Weitzel is the crew chief, with Ray Evernham having departed that operation earlier in the week. There is Weitzel. Bill Weber is right there also.
Well, in Evernham-type fashion, Weitzel coaching his driver down pit road, encouraging his crew. Four tires and fuel, no changes. A good run for Jeff Gordon. This team certainly under the microscope, and especially the pit crew don't want to make any mistakes. They know how many people are watching. Around to the left side, yank up those tires. Fuel is capped off. Tightening the lugs, and Jeff Gordon has a good stop, and his good day continues.
15.3-second pit stop, but it comes just as Kenny Irwin spins down in turn four. No caution yet.
Yes, there is. Yes, there is caution. Well, what a huge break for a lot of drivers who had not pitted, and a bad break for those who had.
Now Kenny Irwin gets the car riding, the Texaco Howland car off and running. I imagine he's too happy with Tony Stewart right now, because that once again was contact between him and Stewart that caused the spin.
And those two have been friends since they were youngsters, having run quarter midgets and just about everything else in the Indianapolis, Central Indiana area. Here it is once again. Remember, our first caution was brought out by a bump between these two, and the second one is going to be for the same reason.
Well, now there are 14 cars on the lead lap. As we watch it again, there the 28 car slides out in front of the 20 car and just gives them a little bit of a tap, and around he goes.
Pit road is open. And again, the entrance is way around at turn three. There is Andretti and Kyle Petty.
Well, obviously, Andretti was able to get by Kyle Petty before the caution flag came out to take the lead. And Sterling Marlin, that Coors Light car, remember, he has a great race car here today. And what a scramble this is going to be as these cars are trying to get their lap back on these cars that will be the leaders when the race restarts.
And unfortunately, a lot of those have pitted late are two laps down, like Ricky Rudd and Jeff Burton and Mark Martin. Let's go to the pits and Bill.
John Andretti wedges his way into his pit stall. No one behind him or in front of him, although they're looking for Park. Andretti has right side tires, no chassis adjustment. This is tires and fuel only. Andretti getting to left sides. Park is in front of him, but Andretti should be able to get out of there okay. That's the 40 goes by. Now the 43 almost hits the 18. They're on their way to Jerry.
Kyle Petty, they just pulled him over on the left rear. Now watch him trying to leave. He pulled right in front of his teammate, John Andretti, who has to jam the brakes on to keep him hitting him. They have to move around the 60 car of Jeffrey Bodine, who they were making an air pressure change there. But Kyle Petty, no, only adjustment was to take the rubber out of the left rear to try to deal with a tight race car.
Tight quarters coming off of pit road back onto the racetrack under caution for the second time this afternoon. And once again, it involves a spin. Lots of bumping and banging going on as per usual here at the half mile Martinsville Speedway.
Back at Martinsville Speedway under caution. The leaders have all made their pit stops by virtue of the caution flag coming out. A good break for Kyle Petty and some of those who had not as yet pitted. Kyle took a rubber out of the left rear. Now, here in the Jeffrey Bodine pit, they made an air pressure change in the left rear tire because the car was loose getting in and loose off. After qualifying so well and running second for much of the afternoon, the car had gotten so loose he couldn't drive it. Maybe those adjustments will make the difference. Let's check in further up pit road with Bill Weber.
Well, Jerry, Mark Martin made another visit to pit road. Again, he got four tires. They topped off the fuel tank, and again, they added wedge to try and tighten his car up.
Now Dale Jarrett also came down pit road just for four tires and fuel. Todd Parrott just talked it over with DJ. They say they agree. Actually, they have an awesome race car. Jarrett asked, what's the deal with the valve stem? Todd said, I really don't know. They're confident. Their car is good. They're just going to need some luck here. To John Kernan.
Earnhardt pitted for four tires right as the caution came out. He was on pit road, so he wound up losing a lap. They just did four tires, did not make any adjustments to the car. Tony Stewart pitted under the caution. He took on four tires. They made a wedge adjustment in the left rear. They also took a piece of tape off of the front air dam, the grill area.
There are 18 cars on the lead lap as we get ready to go back to racing. You see the safety vehicles still on the racetrack, so we'll go at least one more.
Got a weird lineup on the racetrack. The leader of the race is Sterling Marlin, and he is about, let's see, one, two, three, four, fifth back on the outside of the, on the left side of your screen there. All these cars in front of him on the tail end of the lead lap, including Jeff Gordon, Kenny Wallace, Rusty Wallace. Man, it'll be a big scramble.
Whit Watson has the report on this race on the NHRA Advance Auto Parts Nationals from Heartland Park and the World of Outlaws racing at Williams Grove. All that at 9:30 tonight on RPM Tonight on ESPN2. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network, go.com. Lights are still on atop the pace car.
There's some debris down in turns one and two. That's what we're waiting on.
And while we are waiting for them to get the track clear, we'll take another break and be back with more of our live coverage of the NAPA Auto Care 500. Partly cloudy skies over Martinsville Speedway, Virginia. Very pleasant weather conditions as we are 143 laps into the NAPA Auto Care 500. Let's check out the top 15 here. It's Sterling Marlin on top. Mike Skinner, Bobby Labonte, Kyle Petty, and John Andretti. Those are the top five. There are 18 laps currently, cars on the lead lap. Dale Earnhardt, Waltrip, Jarrett, all a lap down.
See, Jeff Gordon, Rusty Walsh, Wardburg, Kenny Walsh, all those cars are right in front of the leader between the safety car and the leader of the race on the tail end of the lead lap.
Down to John Kernan.
Sterling Marlin's crew chief Scott Eggleston has been talking things over with NASCAR officials. They want to know how those four cars lined up in front of them, 55, the 24, the 2, and the 22, pitted under green without losing a lap to them. They think they should be a lap down instead of on the tail end of the lead lap. But here we go back to green.
Thinking, Ned, because everyone wants in front of that 40 car. Jeff Burton, the 99 car, let me in front of that 40 car.
And we have another spin.
And we probably going to have a caution flag, and that's going to let a bunch of cars get a lap back. Can Jeff Burton beat him back? Yes, he did, by just about a yard. Oh, and Tony Stewart's going to coast right back in front of the guys.
It's pretty tore up there on the left rear. He and Brett Bodine ended up against the wall. I think we can probably, if we have replays, show that the 28 car was also involved in this, not surprisingly.
And we see Tony Stewart taking his gloves off and his helmet's next because the car will not go forward.
Tony is not happy at the moment.
No, he isn't.
Climbs out of the car. Brett Bodine was in the lead lap, and he too was involved in the crash. A long time since Tony finished outside the top 15.
Like he's waiting for somebody, probably a 28 car.
And there are his frustrations.
Come on, man, keep going.
replay once again as the NASCAR official comes down and tries to calm Tony down. Here is the replay.
20 car, Tony Stewart, Kenny Irwin going down in turn one.
Contact. Around he goes. Brett Bodine was up on the high side of the racetrack. Didn't look like Brett hit too hard, so maybe he'll be okay.
But he did make contact with the right front against the outside retaining wall. We'll just have to see what kind of damage might have been done.
Last time he finished outside the top 15, Tony Stewart was here in April when he finished 20th after winning his first pole position. Jerry?
Walking along beside Tony, obviously very upset, Tony, but it's been a frustrating day. The 28 car, Kenny Irwin, is that who got you?
Well, I got into him the first time. The first time was my fault, and it was an accident. I had my spotter go down and tell his spotter that it was an accident. And then he gave me a hard time getting by the second time we got by him, and he started catching us after that. I mean, after that, we were a little slower than he was, and I moved up to let him around. He hits me off a two, so I hit him back in three and four and spun him, so he took me out again.
How bad is your car damaged? Can you get back out?
It's tore all the pieces.
All right, upset Tony Stewart. We'll head back to the truck. Guys, fourth in the point standings. They need to get this car back on the racetrack. But right now, the most important thing is let Tony cool off a moment.
Only one DNF in 1999. He ran out of fuel at the first race at Michigan. This could be his second, although they will, of course, try to get that car back in the race. Back at the NAPA AutoCare 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race at Martinsville Speedway in Virginia under caution because of an incident involving Tony Stewart. His Home Depot Pontiac took the major brunt of the incident that involved Brett Bodine and also the 28 car of Kenny Irwin. Now there is history. Tony Stewart and Kenny Irwin have been friends since childhood, but earlier in the race, Tony gave Kenny a little bit of a bump, and Tony admitted that was his fault, and it was an accident. Later in the race, there was another run-in between the two that sent Kenny Irwin spinning for the second time, and now this incident that has put Stewart behind the wall.
Going down in turn one, that's Irwin in the 28 car. Tony Stewart goes in, a little bump, Kenny Irwin, and around he goes, and bam, backs up in that. Brett Bodine, he's the innocent victim of the situation. And just listen to this contact then in turn one.
Well, that has dropped Brett Bodine six laps down and has put Tony behind the wall. That's the onboard camera with Kenny Irwin. And this is what happened as Irwin came around and Tony took out his frustrations.
For sure going to be a battle that he was going to lose because he was up against pretty big odds there.
For sure.
A race car, moving race car.
Since mid-season, Tony Stewart has scored the most points in NASCAR Winston Cup competition, more than anybody else. And also in the past six races, he is fourth in the point standings through the first 27 events of this year.
Now then, we have the real leader behind the pace car.
That is Sterling Marlin.
The real leader of the race is behind the pace car, unlike the last restart where we had four cars on the tail end of the lead lap. All four of those cars did, in fact, get their lap back.
So there are 16 cars now on the lead lap. Ted Musgrave down on the inside. He is actually two laps down.
Now, Jeff Burton got back one of his two laps, and so Jeff Burton is 24th on the restart. It's Marlin, Skinner, Bobby Labonte, Kyle Petty, and John Andretti as Skinner heads to the outside of Musgrave. Michael Walter, Jeffrey Bodine, Steve Park, Ricky Craven, is in ninth position. Running back in 10th is Johnny Benson. And now,
battle for the lead as Mike Skinner takes that low Chevrolet on the inside of Sterling Marlin and will take the lead off turn four.
We've had eight leaders and eight lead changes as Mike Skinner leads for the first time this afternoon. Joe Nemechek has led the most laps so far, 76.
Contact between the two leaders.
Almost a spin there by Skinner as Marlin bumped him.
And here's Jimmy Spencer, that Winston car, trying to get a lap back. Gets by Sterling. Here comes 75 of Musgrave.
First time that Mike Skinner has led here at Martinsville. And the 11th race that he has led in 1999.
Two laps down. He would like to get one of those back.
And Musgrave, once again, trying to get on in. Here comes Kyle Petty. That's a battle for second, the 44 and 40.
Lowe's field summary shows you that Bobby Labonte has taken over second position in the point standings. As of now, Skinner up two to ninth, and Ward Burton down one.
Look at this top 10 here, Bob. Those are on the lead lap. It's a group that sometimes we don't see up there.
Kind of good to see that, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, you look at those point standings. But.
Yeah. And there we see Spencer on the inside of the leader. Here comes Musgrave trying to get their lap back.
One of their two laps. Both of those drivers were two laps down. Now they're just one lap in the distance of the racetrack. If they could get a caution right now, that would be very helpful to them.
Sean Andretti running along. Side Jeremy Mayfield. Andretti is in fourth position, while Mayfield is two laps down in 29th. On board with Bobby Labonte. He had problems in qualifying. He crashed late in the practice session on Friday, had to go to a backup car to qualify, but it's running well. He is up to the fifth position.
He was good in happy hour yesterday afternoon, and he was really coming up through the field before the caution flag. He passed a lot of race cars, and now he's up there in the top five. Still running well.
And there's our pole sitter, Joe Nemechek, right behind Bobby Labonte. Meanwhile, I can see the two guys. He's got one of the laps back, and right behind the leader, Mike Skinner, is Kyle Petty, the Hot Wheels Pontiac, right on that back bumper.
Well, Jamie Spencer and Ted Musgrave says, some of you guys been doing that beating and banging, do just a little bit more. Nothing major, but let us stay out in front of them and get a caution.
Kyle Petty drives down into turn number three, looking to the inside of Mike Skinner. Petty has three top 10 finishes on the short track so far in 1999. He finished eighth at Bristol, 10th at Martinsville, and seventh at Richmond. And also had a 15th place finish in the other Richmond event. Right now he is less than a car length behind the leader, Mike Skinner. Sterling Marlin, John Andretti, and Bobby Labonte complete the top five. We're here 166 laps into this race. More from Martinsville in a moment. Sports Center at 7 o'clock Eastern Time tonight. We'll have the report on the following stories. The National League wildcard race, the Astros, the Reds, and the Mets. Mike Ditka takes his New Orleans Saints back to Chicago. And an AFC Championship rematch involving the Broncos and the Jets. But both those teams are 0-3 so far in 1999. Sports Center is at 7 o'clock tonight on ESPN. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network, Go.com. On board with Bill Elliott, who is currently in 23rd position, a lap down.
In the 99 car, the X-Side Batters Board racing for that 22nd position. That's pretty good. One millennium served.
Yeah.
Darrell Walter, he's also a lap down.
As we show you where everybody is running, and notice these names up here in the top 10. Michael Waltrip, Steve Park, Ricky Craven, Johnny Benson, Kenny Wallace, all of those guys running in the top 12. Rich Bickle is in 13th position. So the guys that are on the lead lap here are some of those that you don't normally see up front. And by the same token, we've got Jarrett, Earnhardt, and others a lap down.
That was all as a result of green flag pit stops and the caution coming out, and others getting to pit under the caution.
Everyone talks about short pitting. Why wouldn't everyone short pit but on those fresh tires? Well, the penalty sometimes is the caution flag comes out, and you're going to be a lap down when they restart.
Jerry, good run by Mike Skinner. He's been in the front for 19 laps now.
Indeed, Bob. I spoke with Larry McReynolds, who told me it's the same car. It's the same low snout car that they started with in 22nd spot in the spring and finished fourth. He said the problem with this car is for about 20 to 40 to 50 laps after we change tires, it won't go anywhere, just like in the spring. But from lap 50 to lap 140, we're a rocket ship. If we can hang on and hold Kyle Petty back there where he is, another 30, 35, 40 laps, we should be able to pull away. And by the way, they dodged a bullet this morning. They found metal in the Oberg filter and made a last-minute engine change prior to today's race.
There's the 31 of the 44 running in first and second spot. There's the third-place car of Sterling Marlin. Back in the fourth spot, right behind Sterling, is John Andretti in the 43.
John Andretti was the winner here in the spring. There we see the 18 car, Bobby Labonte, the Interstate Batteries. Pontiac is back in the fifth spot. You see Joe Nemechek, the 42 car. He is a lap down, two laps down, in 30th spot.
And Jeffrey Bodine, he is in the sixth position in the black number 60. Mark Martin, then the next car there, car number six, he is two laps down in 31st position.
Chevrolet is running in seventh position. See Dale Jarrett, the points leader, going by. He is a lap down in 17th position. And there's Hunt Strickland, the Federated Auto Parts, in the eighth position.
That's the highest running Ford at the moment, BC. Eighth position.
Wow.
So Hunt Strickland having a good run here today. He just passed the one car and the 26, and now the 26 of, there he is, Johnny Benson, has just gotten by the one car of Steve Park, has taken over ninth. And there's Kenny Wallace coming up. He has now moved into the top 10 with the pass on the one car of Steve Park.
Rusty Wallace, who also is trying to put Steve Park another position back. Rusty is in 11th. Park now to 12th. Dale Earnhardt is a lap down in 18th. In 13th position is Jeff Gordon, about 9.5 seconds back of the leader.
Four car Bobby Hamilton is two laps down in 32nd position. The old time pit stops.
Ford Burton, car number 22, he's in 14th position in the Caterpillar car. He's on the lead lap.
Ricky Craven is 15th. He's also on the lead lap, the Midwest Transit Chevrolet.
And he has re-upped for the year 2000 with this team. There's the 9 car of Rich Bickle, who's a little loose off the corner, but still on the lead lap in 16th position, but the last car on the lead lap. So there we show you all the cars that are currently running in the lead lap. Up front, it continues to be Mike Skinner, now having led 31 laps. Joe Nemechek has led the most so far. Kenny Wallace has led second most. And then comes Mike Skinner. Eight leaders and eight lead changes. Average speed of the race is just about 75 miles an hour. Mike Skinner is the leader from Martinsville Speedway in Virginia. 188 laps completed. Kyle Petty, Sterling Marlin, John Andretti, Bobby Labonte are your top five. Stay with us. We'll be right back. ESPN's live coverage of the NAPA AutoCare 500 from Martinsville Speedway in Virginia being brought to you by Valvoline. You can always tell the guys who use Valvoline. By the all-new Chevy Monte Carlo, the side you show the world is up to you. And by Jimmy Dean, America's favorite sausage and sponsor of the number 30, Jimmy Dean Pontiac. We're at Martin. Martinsville Speedway in Virginia. I'm Bob Jenkins along with Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, John Kernan, Bill Weber, and Dr. Jerry Punch. And the Pennzoil copter cam is flying overhead, providing the shots of our leader, Mike Skinner, from high above Martinsville Speedway, down under the 28 car, Kenny Irwin. Let's take a look at the glowing brakes, BP.
You see the one in the corner, we see him hit the brakes. Look at that rotor. The thing is cherry red. Must be 1,000, 1,200 degrees. We're talking about this piece right there that gets redder and redder as he plies the brakes down in the corner. As he takes his foot off the brake pedal, we see how it cools off, but not enough to lose the red glow. Now, once again, down in the corner, incredible heat generated by these brakes here at Martinsville.
You know, a lot of racetracks, we talk about tire management, but here at Martinsville, it's brake management that the driver and the team talks about. Very important to save those brakes, and it's difficult to do. You got a 3,400-pound automobile taking into those turns at about 120 miles an hour and try to roll it down to about 60 miles an hour real quick.
And one other thing you got to be concerned about, we see how close that the rotor is to the tire. If you don't save the brakes, that rotor's going to get hotter and hotter. It's going to melt the bead area of the tire there, and you're going to go in the corner and have a right front tire go flat.
Irwin is two laps down in 35th position. Has had three incidents with Tony Stewart that has put Stewart behind the wall. Back up front, we see Mike Skinner coming up on the 21 car of Elliott Sadler, trying to put him two laps down. Elliott's in 26th.
And we see that Mike Skinner has been able to get back by Jimmy Spencer, also the 75 car of Ted Musgrave. And right now, Skinner has a little over three-second lead on Sterling Marlin, our second-place car.
And at one time, Jimmy Spencer had pulled way out in front of Joe Nemechek, and he got one of his laps back, but now Nemechek has passed him back and has put Jimmy two laps down, once again, in the 27th position.
That is a battle for the second position between the 40, Sterling Marlin, and John Andretti in the 43.
Jeffrey Bodine, Michael Waltrip, and Hut Strickland are battling for 6th and 7th. That's 6th, 7th, and 8th.
They are all along the lead lap. Jeffrey Bodine's car seems to be a little bit loose right now. Most couple of cars that have passed him, and the car seems to not be getting the traction he needs off the corner. Although that time he came off pretty good. Michael pulled right up on him. Michael Waltrip has a good race car here today, it looks like. And of course, he was one of those fortunate ones that had not pitted when many others had, stayed out there and stayed on the lead lap.
Showed you the manufacturer's battle. Chevy is leading, Pontiac running third, all the way down to eighth spot before we find the best running Ford with Hut Strickland.
Chevrolet has kind of dominated as far as laps led today. They received the Revestas rookie points.
Right now, the top rookie of the year candidate, Tony Stewart, is behind the wall, as is Brett Bodine, but everybody else is still running out there. Terry Labonte, I don't know whether we've mentioned it or not, he came into the pits real early and has since gotten back out there, but he is 87 laps down. Now, here is Strickland trying to gain the spot from Jeffrey Bodine.
So Jeffrey Bodine's going to lose two spots in that Power Team Chevrolet, and right behind him, well, not right behind him, but just a few car lengths, is Kenny Wallace, a Square D Chevrolet, who has been awfully strong today. Battle for second spot. Andretti on the inside. Sterling Marlin on the outside.
Well, he gets some traction in that SKP Pontiac and brings him right off the turn and takes the position away.
Just two career wins for John Andretti. His most recent was here in the spring at Martinsville. He is the only driver who has won a race in 1999 that is not in the top 10 in points.
The only driver who's won a race in 99 who's not in the top 10 in points.
Correct.
How about Joe Nemechek?
Nemechek's not in the top 10 in points.
Oh, right.
Okay. I'm sorry. I'm the one that's mixed up.
Thank you.
And we see Skinner behind Kenny Irwin. Trying to put him another lap down.
Skinner a little loose there off the corner, wasn't he?
Yes, he was. Because they've been on these tires long enough, their cars start sliding around, especially coming off the turns.
Just past the 200 lap mark, and Mike Skinner, who made his debut in Winston Cup racing here in the spring of 86, finds himself leading in the fall of 1999. He has been up front for 54 of the 210 laps. It's Andretti, Marlin, Labonte, and Petty in the top five. Back in a moment. Incidents here at Martinsville early on involved just two drivers, Kenny Irwin and Tony Stewart. They collided early. Then later on, there was another incident involving Stewart and Irwin, Kenny spinning around for the second time. And then a little bit later than that, Irwin hits Stewart, sends him into the first turn wall, and puts Tony behind the wall with Stewart, a very frustrated race driver. Down to Bill Weber.
And Bob, there was a tremendous amount of frustration throughout both Joe Gibbs racing teams. In fact, the 18 team discussed the incident on the radio, and they were very upset about it. They had a clear view of it and said that their car was intentionally taken out. And basically what they referred to was the fact that Yates is a two-car operation. They have a guy running for the championship, and paybacks can really hurt you. Well, obviously something like that always gets back to the other team. Robert Yates sent a message to the 20 team, reminding them that that is not his driver for the future, and he may not be responsible for the wheel holder in that car. Tempers really flurried down here at this short track, and we still have a long way to go.
This is Kenny Irwin we're riding along with, the Rebestos onboard camera, as Dallenbach goes by.
When we come to Martinsville, things can always get heated as far as action on the racetrack and tempers.
We saw those breaks we saw a few minutes ago.
That's for sure. This will end the short track season for 1999. In a couple of weeks, as a matter of fact, we will be at the fastest speedway that NASCAR races on, Talladega, for coverage there.
Petty has fallen back, so I'm battling for the second spot. Just Martin to go. Martin just slowed dramatically coming off of turn two. Don't know what the problem is with Valvoline Ford. It looks like he's headed for the pits, maybe a flat tire.
Right front tire is flat.
Mark was running in 28th position, two laps down, and comes in for an unscheduled pit stop because of a flat right front, Bill.
And he'll have to make a long trip down pit road. It'll take him an extra long amount of time to get here. Jimmy Fenning has already warned his guys, you may have to lift up on the right-hand side of the car so they can get the jack underneath it. They plan to make a four-tire stop, which will cost them a lot of time. Obviously, they'll be hoping that the caution flag does not come out. They do get the jack under the car, jack up the right-hand side. Right side tires are going on. They make a chassis adjustment, and now they may only go with right side tires, and they do. But Martin away. It just took them too long to get down pit road. They couldn't take the chance to put on left side tires. They've got the right front, and they want to look at it.
Took him 14 seconds to get reshot on the right side.
But that's going to put Mark three laps down now. He was two, as we see this battle here between the two car of Rusty Wallace and the 24 car of Jeff Gordon. That's 10th and 11th.
Gordon moves to the inside of Rusty. And they go through the corner, banging on each other's doors.
Let me correct myself. Mark Martin is now being shown as four laps down because as he was coming out of the pits, the leader passed him, so he is four laps down to the leader.
Move Jeff Gordon up into the top 10 as he successfully passes Rusty Wallace.
And there's Jeffrey Bodine, the ninth place car, directly in front of Jeff Gordon. driver to start the season. 28 car, Kenny Irwin, back in the pits. Oh, we got something wrong there with the right front. They can't get...
Broke off over here. Hold up, Raymond.
Something broken.
I'm wondering if it's one of the studs.
Okay, what we're going to do is get it put together, get it behind the wall, and we're going to get a hub on there.
In fact, the hub is broken.
That thing had gotten awfully hot.
Turn around real easy and put it down here. Somebody's going to have to help him back it up. Get to the wheel there. Back him up.
So they're going to put the 28 car behind the wall.
Come on, go ahead. Slow down.
Bill Weber is down in Mark Martin's pit.
Okay, guys, take a real quick look at this. This is the right front off of Mark Martin's car. You can see basically how the sidewall's just blown away here. Jimmy Fennick told Mark it's the sidewall, but it could have started with a bead problem. Now, Betty, you talked about this a little bit on NASCAR today on how the brakes not only heat up, but so does the sidewall and so does the bead. Is this that typical problem you were talking about?
That's exactly what I was talking about just a moment ago when the 28 car, we saw all that red brake rotor. That rubber just can't stand that kind of temperature.
And Mark was running awfully hard out there. He was gaining on the leader. He had a chance, he thought, to catch him and get one of his laps back. And so he had no choice when he was that far down but to run as hard as he could possibly go and probably put just a little bit too much strain, a little bit too much heat on it.
Now he finds himself right behind the leader once again and is trying to get one of his six laps back.
One of the four laps, Bob.
I'm sorry. Yep. Back in 35th position.
Does.
Yeah, it's been the Skinner once again loose coming off the corner, and so Mark now just three laps down in the 35th position. Skinner continues to lead. He has been out front now more laps than anyone else. He's been up front for 78 of the 234 circuits. AutoCare 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race from Martinsville Speedway in Virginia is nearing the halfway point, just nine more laps until halfway. There are currently three cars off the racetrack, Brett Bodine, Tony Stewart, and the 28 machine of Kenny Irwin. There you see Brett Bodine's car right behind Kenny's. Well, Brett is back there because of the accident that involved Irwin and Stewart. And a few minutes ago, Brett also took out his frustrations on Kenny. It's a typical Martinsville race, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Irwin sits back there waiting to get the hub fixed on his car. You notice, though, that Brett ran over with helmet on.
He probably put it on to go over there.
Yeah.
He's probably smart guy.
Moments ago on the racetrack, this little incident between Jimmy Spencer and Dale Earnhardt.
Wow, a little contact. Spencer goes around and just about spun out down the front straightaway, but he got things back under control.
Earnhardt is one lap down. Spencer two laps down. Spencer running back in 27th, and Earnhardt is in the 18th position. Down to John Kernan.
You mentioned that Brett Bodine came over with his helmet on. Actually, he's been sitting in his race car while the team was working on it. After Irwin pulled in, Brett unhooked his belts, brought the window net down, got out of the car, came over, had the confrontation with Kenny. Now, the reason we have not talked with Kenny is I asked him if he would be willing to talk on camera, and he told me no, he had nothing to say right now.
Sometimes discretion is the better part of valor.
We saw that left front just a moment ago when they got a close-up camera on the left front. We did see some sheet metal rubbing that left front tire. Right front looks to be okay, but it's down the... As we go down the backstretch, we'll see. Right there, oh, just a little bit of smoke.
Yep.
But it's better that it's the left front as opposed to the right front.
Just two more laps and $10,000 will be presented to the leader at the halfway point. Will it be Mike Skinner? Right now, he enjoys a 2.5 second lead over John Andretti. Here's the battle for the third spot. Sterling Marlin just up ahead of Bobby Labonte.
Oh, Sterling gets in the corner and gets it really loose. And the 18 car Labonte just goes right by.
There are some cars really slipping and sliding around. Jimmy Spencer is in the pits, and John Kernan sees him as he leaves.
Quick work for Spencer's crew. They took on four tires as the chassis adjusted to the left wheel. We saw the contact out there on the racetrack. The left front fender has been in a little bit, but it's not been in enough to touch the tire. So they didn't have to pull it out very far. Spencer got the service, went back onto the racetrack.
Ted Musgrave and Jeremy Mayfield have also made green flag pit stops, and Tony Stewart is about to come back out onto the racetrack. They've been working on his number 20 car. And he's coming out from behind the wall now. He's a lot of laps down.
We have reached the halfway point. Mike Skinner was leading when the cross flags were displayed, so he gets the $10,000.
From Gatorade.
Yep. Here's the sixth and seventh place battle between Brett Strickland and Jeff Gordon. And there is Tony Stewart, who had to go by both the 11 and 28 to get back out on the racetrack. But Tony Stewart is headed back onto the speedway.
And Rich Bickle is in the pits. He was running in the 17th position.
There you see the rundown. Skinner has a 2.3 second lead on Andretti. And he had about a 3.5 second lead not too long ago. So John Andretti is getting a little bit closer.
Jeff Gordon just took over the sixth position from Hut Strickland. There he is.
Nevertheless, a great run for Hut Strickland, the Federated Auto Parts Ford today.
Jeff Gordon is shown as the fastest car on the racetrack, at least last lap. He was well above 100. Rather above 87 miles an hour. Now there is the pole sitter, Joe Nemechek, who is two laps down and just about to go three laps down to Mike Skinner. So Joe Nemechek's hopes of winning his second NASCAR Winston Cup race have kind of been dashed, although he started from the pole and had high hopes when the green flag dropped. There are 12 cars currently on the lead lap as we are 255 laps in. It's Skinner, Andretti, Bobby Labonte, Sterling Marlin, and Kyle Petty. We're just past halfway, and that means a lot of people are up getting the concessions that they need for the final half of this NASCAR Winston Cup race here at Martinsville. Well, a National Hockey League doubleheader coming up on Tuesday on ESPN2 beginning at 7:30 Eastern. The Dallas Stars face off against the Detroit Red Wings, and then at 10:30 it's the Anaheim Mighty Ducks against the Phoenix Coyotes. The Stars, of course, the defending champions, raise their banner and beat the Pittsburgh Penguins on Friday night. Mario Lemieux, of course, the owner of the Penguins now. But the hockey season is in full stride. Thank goodness it's back. And you'll be able to see a doubleheader on Tuesday night. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Part of the Go Network, go.com. Mike Skinner continues to lead this race with a 1 1/3 second advantage on John Andretti.
I believe that lead is shrinking a little bit. You see that blue-red number 43 coming in there? John Andretti.
Indeed, the interval has come down from 2 seconds now to 1.4.
As we saw Jeff Burton peel off into the pit area, Ricky Craven is in.
And you can see that Andretti is almost, he's faster almost every lap. And Skinner now, you know, Larry McReynolds said that after 30, 40 laps, the 31 car got to get better and better. It's Andretti's car that's getting better and better on these long runs.
Bill Weber has more.
And they've been telling that to John Andretti. Of course, he can see the 31 now, but they've been telling him for the last 20 or 25 laps that the 31 car was using up its tires. And that the 43 has been much smoother. So they've been telling Andretti, you're reeling him in, you're reeling him in. He can see him, and now they can almost feel him. So John Andretti trying to catch the 31 car on the racetrack for the lead. Let's go further down pit road.
Well,
Well, Jeff Burton back in for four tire change. He actually came in on lap 150 and 151 for right side and then left side, respectively. They're keeping fresh tires on this car every 105 to 110 laps, and it doesn't seem to make much difference. He's still losing some significant ground on the racetrack.
Ken Schrader hits pit road. He's several laps down, three laps down in 28th as he comes in for a change of rubber and a refuel. Joe Nemechek going to be driving this car next year, huh?
Yes. Signed on this week. I think that'll be a good match. Nemechek and the Andy Petrie on the car. Oakwood Homes will be the sponsor next year.
Of course, Ken Schrader will be going to the 36, and Mike Skinner is just in a whole bunch of traffic right now, and because he is, that interval between first and second continues to shrink.
Yeah, he's having a harder time now passing that traffic, Bob, because his tires are worn out. He's slipping and sliding over the racetrack, and John Andretti is taking advantage of that, moving in much closer. He's under a second now.
One problem Skinner has, as cars start to make pit stops and come on the racetrack, with these newer tires, they're able to pass the leader, and they're getting position on Skinner as he almost makes contact with Robert Presley. So he is passing cars and also being passed.
John Andretti drove the victory here in the spring. He started from the furthest back of any winner in the modern era. Started in 21st spot and drove the victory lane. Running three laps down in the 22nd spot.
Here's Jimmy Spencer passing Dale Earnhardt. The 23 car has fresh tires on, and no incident there. They got together a little bit earlier.
And we still see that tire rub on the left front of Earnhardt's car.
Yeah, he's passing good cars. He's up to 12th now. He's the first car that's one lap down.
Sideways coming off the corner, though.
Yes, the tires are really starting to go away on the three car right now as he tries to hit the accelerator and come off the corner. He's having a hard time doing it.
Mike Bliss slows and heads for pit road. Look at the four car of Bobby Hamilton, who's sideways. Take a look at our Bud Race recap. Mike Skinner has led now 117 in the 273 laps, eight lead changes, three caution periods, totaling 26 laps, and the average speed is up to more than 78 miles an hour. Here are those who have led at least one lap. There are eight of them. Jeffrey Bodine has been credited with leading one lap here this afternoon, and the off-the-track list is pretty short, really, with Kenny Irwin the only one behind the wall. Rusty Wallace is on pit road. Jerry is there.
Scheduled pit stop for Rusty Wallace, still looking for that win number 50. Thought it would come here in the spring when he had such a good run, but it has not been the case. They will get four tires. Scheduled pit stop for the Miller crew. They come to the left side of the car. Air pressure adjustment. Rusty is down and away.
16.9 second pit stop for Rusty Wallace.
And you have the team, the pit crew on the two car, the Miller Lite car, has an incentive program for each pit stop that they make under 17 seconds. The team rewards with them some money. Today, thinking about all the folks, what they're going through in Eastern North Carolina, the pit crew, all the money they make today from their incentive program goes to the flood victims in Eastern North Carolina.
Very nice.
That is a nice gesture.
Skinner has cleared all of that traffic, and now John Andretti has to come through it.
Here's Natives in the pits.
By the way, that 22 car up there that you see up on the right, that is, of course, Ward Burton. He just lost a lap in the 10th position, so nine cars now on the lead lap.
This is going to cost Andretti a tremendous amount of time as he tries to work his way through these slower cars or these lap cars. Oh, as Dahlenbach goes by, Nadeau just almost making contact.
Nadeau just came out of the pits.
And again, the these cars that you see passing Mike Skinner have already made pit stops and have the fresher tires. More from Martinsville after this. Welcome you back to live coverage of the NAPA AutoCare 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race from Martinsville Speedway in Virginia. Sterling Marlin, one of those in the lead lap, has come in for a pit stop. John Kernan.
It's a four-tire change for Sterling Marlin, also a chassis adjustment. The car has been very, very loose. You can see some of the telltale signs as the grill is pushed in just a little bit, but it's not, shouldn't cause any major problems with the car. Quick pit stop. Sterling is headed back out onto the track.
Been an interesting race. We've had only three cautions during this event, all three of them for incidents involving Kenny Irwin and Tony Stewart, and at least one of them was sort of ill-timed with pit stops, and that has resulted in several of the top drivers being a lap down, including Dale Jarrett, the points leader. He is currently ninth, but is one lap down.
And check this out, Bobby Labonte, we've been paying attention to the 31 car Skinner and the 43 car Labonte, the 18 interstate car, has caught these two guys. They're the first three cars.
But these two cars here, that the two car of Rusty Wallace and the 58 of Ricky Craven, have made pit stops, so they have fresh tires on them, so they're in there mixing up with the leaders.
Mark Martin, second in points, three laps down in 22nd position. Tony Stewart is 42nd in the running order right now, 105 laps down, as he spent many laps behind.
Oh, and he just ran into the 9 car of Rich Bickle, and caution is out. Going to be a huge
break. Oh, and Andretti can't avoid running into the back of Bobby Hamilton.
Oh, man.
John Andretti, who was had a very, very good car and had moved up to second, led four laps earlier, has a badly damaged Pontiac.
I saw a bunch of water. I'm assuming that was the water out of the STB Pontiac that I saw on the racetrack.
Fourth caution of the afternoon. Let's take a look at it once again.
Got three cars going down the back there. There were four deep for a moment, but Kenny Wallace was coming into the pits. But Tony Stewart had started down on the inside of Rich Bickle in the 9 car. The 9 car came down into him, I guess is the way to put it. Perhaps didn't know he was there. And around he goes. Here comes John Andretti with the wheels locked. Nowhere to go, and right into Bobby Hamilton.
Man, oh, man. You see Kenny Wallace going down pit road while all this is going on. And there we see the spin by the 9 car. There we see the 4 car sitting there, stopped. And here comes Andretti about right now. Mm. Boom.
Full of Andretti here in a moment.
I'm telling you. 16 car goes by. Watch, here he comes.
Oh. And the camera still is ticking.
Man, oh man.
So Bobby Hamilton enters pit road with damage to the back end of his car, actually exits pit road.
Now, Kenny Wallace had headed into the pits right then. Of course, his pit crew saw what happened there. They said, go on through, come around. So he stayed on the lead lap. Now there are 6 cars on the lead lap.
And that would be Wallace, Jeffrey Bodine, Kyle Petty, Jeff Gordon, Bobby Labonte, and Mike Skinner. And here they come. Down to John Kernan.
Bobby Labonte pulls into his pit stall. It'll be a four-tire change, no chassis adjustment. They did make an air pressure adjustment. Jimmy Makar reminded Bobby just before this pit stop. He said, hey, we're a lot better than everybody else out there on the racetrack after 40 laps. So just take care of your tires in the early parts of the run. Mud nuts are tight. Now to Dr. Jerry Punch.
It has been 168 laps since Mike Skinner was pitted. It's perfect timing for him. They make a slight air pressure adjustment. Mike said the car just a bit loose coming off. Otherwise, it is perfect. Left side tires going on. Classic pit stop. Bill Weber.
4 tires, half around in the right rear. 2 cans of fuel for Jeff Gordon. He was a little tight in the center.
We saw that great pit stop by Mike Skinner, and Bobby Labonte wins the race off of pit road.
He beats Mike Skinner and Jeff Gordon off of pit road. And others now not on the lead lap are making pit stops. We'll take a break and be back with more of our live coverage in just a moment of the NAPA AutoCare 500. The 1999 NASCAR Winston Cup short track season ends here today. You're looking at the past 11 winners of short track racing, and you will see that all of them are different. We have had 11 different winners in the last 11 races. Tony Stewart, the most recent at Bristol. Will there be a 12th today? Well, there is a driver leading right now, Bobby Labonte, who was not among the faces that you just saw. As a matter of fact, Ned, looks like our chances are pretty good here this afternoon.
Yeah, really, as we look at those 11 short track winners in the last 11 races, only one who are in the lead lap right now is among that list, and that is Jeff Gordon. Yep. There are seven drivers on the lead lap, and he's the only one that's on that 11-driver list.
John is with Jimmy Makar.
Bobby Labonte's crew chief. Bobby, the leader now. Jimmy, how's the car?
Well, right now it's pretty good. We're a little bit tight early in the run. We still are a little bit tight early in the run, but it seems after 30 or laps or so, the car really starts to come around. So we're not quite as good as them guys early in a run, but I think as long as we keep getting long runs like this, I feel like we're probably as good as anybody on long run.
Bobby Labonte up in front right now, hoping to stay there. Now to Dr. Jerry Punch.
All right, up with Larry McReynolds. Larry, it looks like you guys may have the car to beat. Awfully good.
Well, you know, Bobby Labonte looks awfully strong, and it's Martinsville. You know, John Andretti looked like he had a strong race car, and unfortunately got wrapped up in an accident, and we still got 200 laps to go, so we're just going to keep trying to run our race. Our car needs these long green runs that it's getting right now. It's a little iffy for 20 or so laps. We need these long green runs.
Toughest part is keeping your guy calm.
Pretty much, if I can keep him from driving in the corner so deep. I keep telling him next week at Charlotte's when you need to go in the corner deep, not today at Martinsville, because when he floats it down in there, it's good off the corner. But when he drives it in too deep, it washes up. Can't get a bite off the corner.
All right, the old saying, slower is faster here at Martinsville. Let's check in with Bill.
With Jeff Gordon's crew chief, Brian Weitzel. Obviously, your car's performed very well today.
Car's been pretty good. We're still a little snug in the middle, but just made an adjustment for that. Got a good break there, got a bad break earlier on, but real happy. Jeff's feels pretty good in the car, so 200 laps to go, it's still a long race.
How do you feel?
A lot better than I thought it would. A little nervous after that first one, but it's all came around and we're running pretty good.
Good luck.
Thank you.
He has been very calm on the radio, and as I mentioned earlier, he really has taken a page out of Everett Ham's book, not only coaching his driver, but encouraging his pit crew as the car comes down pit road for every stop, reminding them exactly what they're going to do, how to do it, and to do it well.
Just in case you haven't heard, those rumors regarding Ray Evernham and his departure from Hendrick Motorsports and Jeff Gordon were confirmed earlier. He is gone. Brian is the new crew chief of the 24 car. Ray's future, well, it's undecided right now. He'll have an announcement, I'm sure, before too long. There is Jeff Gordon, who is running in the third position, the points leader. Dale Jarrett is running in ninth spot. He's a lap down. Mark Martin is back in 20th. Tony Stewart's had a rough afternoon, and Jeff Burton has also lost a couple of laps and is in the 16th position. This caution period continues here at Martinsville, so we'll take another break from the NAPA AutoCare 500. ESPN's live coverage of the NAPA AutoCare 500 from Martinsville Speedway being brought to you by Daytona USA, the official attraction of NASCAR. By Mobile One Synthetic Mobile, nothing outperforms Mobile One. And by Quality Care Service at your Ford and Lincoln Mercury dealers. Join ESPN this Friday at 10 o'clock, and you'll get to see a double dose of Sports Century 50 Greatest Athletes. Number 17, former NBA great Magic Johnson. He led the Lakers to 5 championships. He was a 3-time MVP and a 12-time NBA All-Star and an Olympic gold medal winner with the 92 Dream Team. Then at 10:30 Eastern, number 16, former Boston Red Sox slugger Ted Williams, the last player in the major league history to hit over 400 in a season that happened in 1941. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network, go.com. Speaking of legends in sport, Richard Petty is one. The Andretti name, of course, is one. And Bill is with John.
And it's a very disappointed John Andretti. What happened?
Well, I just
I went up to, down into turn three, and I didn't know the track was blocked, and unfortunately it was, and with as old as my tires were and everything, I couldn't get the car stopped, but it's real unfortunate the accident even had to happen. I guess one guy's out there just terrorizing the place, and he's taking me out of Pocono, so it's hard to be diplomatic, but you know, he needs to settle down, I guess, and all of us need to learn how to settle down every now and then, I guess.
When you say you didn't know it was there, John, this is a short track. You get around here in a hurry, but you always hope you have a little advance warning on those things.
Well, it helps because, you know, there were a lot of cars that we were lapping, and there were cars on new tires that we were running around, and I was up on the outside. If I'd have been on the bottom, it would have been no problem, but I was letting some guys go down underneath me, and I was just trying to play it safe, I thought, and unfortunately, I played it the wrong way.
And they've got a lot of damage to their race car. They're going to try and get it back out. Green's coming out.
On lap 312.
And the 40 car Sterling Marlin is on the tail end of the lead lap. When they receive Dale Earnhardt, the Goodrich Chevrolet, down there trying to get a lap back as well.
And he is back on the lead lap. He's in front of the leader, Bobby Labonte.
Earnhardt in eighth. Now on the lead lap. The lead of the race is Bobby Labonte. Skinner is second, followed by Gordon. And Kenny Wallace, who has run in the top five just about all race long.
This is our leader, Bobby Labonte, the Circuit City onboard cameras. He looks back at Mike Skinner, the low Chevrolet, as he closes it right on the back bumper. Sterling Marlin is now going to lap down in the eighth position. With Dale Earnhardt up in seventh spot.
Labonte has had two top fives in his 49 short track races, and both have been this season. He was third at Richmond in May and second at Richmond in September. As far as here at Martinsville, no top fives in the last 13 races, but he's leading at the moment.
In a backup car. He
yes.
wrecked here on Friday in practice. At the end of the practice before qualifying, came out with a backup car. Did not have a lap on the racetrack. Put it in 25th position, and here he is leading this race. Dale Earnhardt trying desperately to stay on that lead lap. And you see Bobby Labonte right behind him. Ted Musgrave out there in car number 26 has gotten one of his laps back.
And
still two laps down.
You also see that battle there for third spot as Kenny Wallace tries to go outside of Jeff Gordon, does so successfully, and move Kenny up to third.
Wow.
Benzoil Copter Cam is showing you the overhead action. So Kenny Wallace has been very, very good so far today. From the drop of the green flag, he's led 45 laps, now finds himself in the third spot.
And Brian Watson said that Jeff Gordon was complaining about being a little snug or a little tight in the middle of the corner. Said they corrected for it, but evidently still a little bit snug because he's not able to make that charge that we thought he would as the green flag waved.
As a matter of fact, he's now under fire from Kyle Petty. Was struggling before the pit stop, but they appear to have improved his car.
Yeah, on the long runs, Kyle's car got very, very loose, but now that they've put new tires on it, expect to put him back in competition, right, Jerry?
Exactly, Ned. In fact, just before the pit stop, Kyle said, this thing's driving like a tractor. It's plowing off the corner. Every time I say, well, I almost hit the wall. Next time, well, I nearly missed it that time. They made some major adjustments. Air pressure out in the right front, in the left rear. They raised the track bar, and now it is much, much better than it was prior to that stop.
Well, we really got a confusing leaderboard right now because some of these guys' cars run awfully good on used tires and some run awfully good on the new tires. Bobby Labonte, Mike Skinner seem to run awfully good after 30 or 40 laps. Jeff Gordon's car is another one that runs good after the tires get good and worn. But Kyle Petty looks like his car is really good on the pressure tires.
And we'll have at least one more pit stop, right?
Yes. We'll have to make another pit stop at least for fuel. And, of course, they'll take tires on, too, because, as we have seen, after about 100, 120 laps, they really start skating around.
And we have 178 laps to go, as your scoring information shows you in the upper left.
Hey,
Kenny Wallace, I think, right now is the unknown. I don't know if his car is better with the fresher tires or if the tires are a little warm.
He's been good all day.
Yes, he has. He made a green flag pit stop, like many did early in the race. Got a lap down, but now has gotten that back. And it's, well, he actually came into the pits as the caution was coming out this last time. That saved him. Stayed on the lead lap. Now up there in third place.
He's coming off his worst finish of 1999. He finished last at Dover, Kenny Wallace did, after starting 34th.
Had an engine problem there. Mm-hmm. And he's working on Sterling Marlin.
He sure is.
And right now, Mike Skinner cannot keep up with Bobby Labonte. Labonte's pulled out 3/4 of a second ahead of Mike Skinner.
Labonte's the fastest car on the racetrack. Last lap, 90.7 to Skinner's 90.3.
Well, if that Pontiac Interstate battery's Pontiac gets better as time goes on, he will be tough after they get about 30, 40 laps on these tires.
Last lap, Labonte was even faster. More on Skinner from Jerry.
And each time by, as you might expect, Mike Skinner is saying, Larry, we're tight, we're tight. And Larry very calmly says, I got you, good buddy. We're going to be fine. We got 170 laps to go before we're going to come in again. Just stay put. And Mike says, okay, I got you. So he is tight right now. They should make their final pit stop with about 30 laps to go before the checkered flag if we stay green. So around 460 to 470.
That's when the time that the guys will really be trying to think about short pitting and stop with 50 or 60 laps to go. Do they change two tires, four tires? Do the guys run as far as they can, just fuel only? Boy, there's a lot of stuff going on in these guys' minds right now as to what to do.
That's right. If this thing goes green the rest of the way, there will be a lot of thinking going on and different strategies.
Put together, of course, 4 top 10 finishes to begin the season. He finished 4th at Daytona, 6th at Rockingham, 4th at Las Vegas, and 6th at Atlanta. Then had some bad races, but overall has had a very good year and finds himself 11th in the point standings, but very, very close to Terry Labonte as we entered this event for 10th.
He's beginning to pick up now a little bit on Bobby Labonte. Like he's closed in a car length or so.
And that time by, he was faster than Labonte, and we can see that he's getting closer and closer. He's only a half second behind now. It was 3/4 just a moment ago. Watch as he just drives in. Wow, closes in on Labonte.
That tight race car is beginning to work a little bit for him now as he gets those tires heated up.
Reduces the interval to about 3 car lengths now. Finished 4th here at Martinsville in the spring after starting 22nd. A year ago, he finished 16th. And as you can see, Dale Earnhardt continues to be on the lead lap in the 7th position, running just ahead of Bobby Labonte. There is Dale Jarrett, who is a lap down, but still running in the top 10. He's 9th.
Jeffrey Bodine, the power team Chevrolet, is on the lead lap. He's currently running in 6th position.
Jeffrey came in and made a late pit stop during this last caution. Of course, he was already back there anyway, so it didn't hurt him that much. He pitched just a little bit there. DJ would like to get up there and try to get his lap back, but he's got a lot of race cars to pass before he can get that opportunity. Plus, he's holding off Rusty Wallace, who's running in 10th position.
Yeah, that is a battle for position between DJ and Rusty. On board with Wallace, the king of the short tracks in the 1990s with 16 wins, 43 top fives, 57 top tens, and 53 short track races led. that record of Rusty Wallace. There have been 73 short track races in the 1990s, and nine drivers have competed in every one of them. And here they are: Rusty Wallace, Dale Earnhardt, Mark Martin, Terry Labonte, Ken Schrader, Ricky Rudd, Sterling Marlin, Jeffrey Bodine, and Michael Waltrip.
There was something, either a little smoke or a little fluid or something coming out of Jeffrey Bodine's car. I noticed there a minute ago, Jerry, you hearing anything in the pits?
Ned, we are. We're hearing some corner workers and some spotters telling the cars behind the power team machine you're looking at right here that there's some fluid coming out of the back of the 60 car. They've warned Dale Jarrett and some of the other cars behind them to be careful. Now, they've also put a very close eye on the back of the car. We don't see anything right yet, but it seemed a little bit ago there's maybe an overflow hose in the back of the car there where, if indeed he is overheating, that's where the water would come out, just beneath the rear bumper there, probably on the left side.
I did see something about three laps ago, but right now I don't see anything.
There he comes. There we see the water coming out the back. It does look like the overflow for the radiator. They run the hose from the radiator back in the back so that when the overflow, it does run hot and the water comes out, it'll go at the rear of the car, not under the car, and they're spinning their own water. There it is, just a little bit.
Ahead of Jeffrey Bodine is Jeff Gordon and Kyle Petty. They're running fourth and fifth.
They're about 3 seconds behind the leader, Bobby Labonte. Goes up to go around the injured Carl Tony Stewart. Almost let Jeff Gordon get right alongside of him, but now they're back nose to tail.
And now we'll go up front, check on first and second. There's Labonte and Skinner, separated by just a few car lengths as Labonte comes up on Dave Marcus once again.
Dave moves to the high side. Bobby go down on the inside.
We'll check the speeds at the line for you. See who's best.
Well, that time, the 31 car was faster, but he ran up on, actually, the 44 car was second fast, and yeah. Jeffrey Bodine. But I think part of that, Bobby Labonte, not making excuses for him, but he did come off of that turn on the inside of Dave Marcus, and that hurt his lap speed.
And once again, Jeffrey Bodine is the fastest car on the racetrack among the top six.
Wow. And we see, as a matter of fact, he's been able to pull away a little bit from Dale Jarrett and Rusty Wallace.
Very consistent.
Maybe he didn't want to let DJ pass him. He said, I've got a fast race car. Just need a little time to get it set in here. And he's got it working. Consistent with the fastest.
Four wins here at Martinsville, most recently this race in 1992. He won both races here in 1990.
Jeffrey Bodine there, getting closer and closer to the DuPont Chevrolet of Jeff Gordon. Meanwhile, we check the interval between Bobby Labonte, the leader, and Jeffrey Bodine, and we see in five laps, he got 3/10 of a second closer to Bobby Labonte. And he gained another 1/10 of a second. That's 4/10.
Now he's got a little bit of traffic to contend with.
And that will impede his progress. There's no doubt about that.
Down the inside of Dave Marcus in the 2-3 Chevrolet. Dave is running back in 38th position. He is 41 laps down.
spin behind the wall.
And you see a guy, we just saw him go out of the frame there. A guy really wants a caution flag right now that has a good race car is Dale Earnhardt. Remember, he passed the leader, and the leader can't catch him.
Bobby Labonte has been out front for the last 57 laps here at Martinsville. Bob Jenkins, Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, John Kernan, Bill Weber, Dr. Jerry Punch rejoining you at Martinsville Speedway in Virginia, the 28th of 34 races in the Winston Cup season for 99. It's the NAPA AutoCare 500 from Martinsville that's being led by the 18 Interstate Batteries Pontiac driven by Bobby Labonte with Mike Skinner in the low Chevy hot on his heels in second spot. Kenny Wallace, Kyle Petty, and Jeff Gordon complete the top five. We've got 141 laps to go.
Bobby Labonte there. You know, Ned, I wonder, that car that he wrecked on Friday afternoon, the primary car he brought to Martinsville, as Skinner goes right up. If it was better than this car, man, that was really would have been something else, wouldn't it?
It really would have been, because as we mentioned earlier, he did wreck in practice, had to go to the backup car. This was the backup car. You see it's got those orange. Here we'll see the wreck as he comes off of turn four. See, there's the green car, Bobby Labonte, and he lost it. Coming up, the back end started to get away, and then he hit down on the inside, and you see the damage that was done to the left side, even cracked the wall. Of course, they've repaired that since then. Bobby was a little angry at himself. Not necessarily to the car, but that's the only thing that's close to him you can take it out on.
Well, he's smiling now because he has that backup car out in front of everybody else by about a half second over second place Skinner. Here is the switch of fifth position as Jeffrey Bodine goes to the fifth spot, putting Kyle Petty back to sixth. Down to Jerry Punch.
Well, the fact that he's passing cars is good news for the power team, but it's not good news because of the moisture in the water we saw coming out a little bit ago. They are trying to get the water tank ready here in the pits for Jeffrey to come down pit road. They are hearing that we may have a caution flag situation to allow an ambulance out of the infield, and if that is the case, in the next few laps or so, they're going to try to wait to bring him in. The car has lost quite a bit of water. We are now being told it is overheating. Some of the cars behind him have backed off. They're concerned that he may blow, and if he were to blow, he'd be right in front of the current points leader, Dale Jarrett, Rusty Wallace, a few of those guys. So we'll keep an eye on the 60 car. They're going to try to stay on the racetrack and get a caution flag before they come in to put any more water in it.
And if we should get that caution for the ambulance to move across the track, it would be for the track worker who was injured while going to the scene of one of the crashes. And he was injured and being treated currently in the infield medical center.
I tell you, the 60 car might be overheating, might be doing this and doing that, but he's running pretty fast. The last time by, he was the second fastest car, and he's about to close in on the back bumper of Jeff Gordon. He's only 4 seconds behind the leader, Bobby Labonte. You see Jeff Gordon and Jeffrey Bodine.
Take a look at a Hardy's Field summary and the shakeup in the points. Bobby Labonte has retaken second position from Mark Martin in the points. And in the second five, we see Mike Skinner moving up two spots. Ward Burton down one. Right now, moving out of the top 10 in points, Terry Labonte. Sterling Marlin moving up one to the 15th spot. And then a whole bunch of changes back here, 16 through 20. Bodine moving inside of Jerry Nadeau in 36.
This is in the front bumper of Mike Bliss, Jimmy Dean Pontiac, and let's take a taste of the race and see what kind of RPM, what kind of speed that Bliss is able to turn. You can see Bliss on the outside groove as he's letting the faster cars go by on the inside. Accelerates down to about 115 miles per hour, but he'll slow dramatically all the brakes he's got down to 59 miles per hour before he starts building the speed back up.
Jeffrey Bodine goes by on the inside. It might be bad news for Jeffrey Bodine. The water we saw, we don't see any water now. Might mean there's not any water in there.
Mm-hmm. If that's the case, he won't last long if there's not any water in there. But I can't believe that he would have lost all of it. But don't see it losing anymore, do we?
No. Another car alongside as the camera pans back and watch Kyle Petty's Hot Wheels car go. I don't know if they sell cars with that tire mark down the right side. Hot Wheels might have some.
I think they do, Benny. And they'll have a good model to go from here after today.
You've got a lot for sale here this afternoon.
Caution's out. Caution's out for something. I don't know why, but it's out.
For the ambulance to leave the infield and take that injured track worker to the local hospital.
Now there will only be, there's right now only 127 laps to go, so they're within a pit window. They can make it on one more pit stop. Dale Earnhardt likes this because he gets to go all the way around the racetrack, one of seven cars on the lead lap.
And that really is big. There's only seven cars on the lead lap, so when they restart, he can start right behind the sixth place car. That's big.
Real big.
I mean, if you had 25 cars on the lead lap, it wouldn't be such a big deal, but only seven cars. Now, they might leave pit road closed for just a while. We'll have to see.
This is our fifth caution of the race. There is the ambulance leaving the infield care center.
There are cars that are about two-thirds of the way around this racetrack. When they're running slow and under caution, they spread out around the racetrack. And since all the cars, or at least all the John Andretti, are still out on the racetrack, and they're putting his car in the truck now, so he won't be back out.
Here comes the ambulance at the... So the pit road is still closed because they need to get this ambulance in around pit road, around the racetrack, to get over to the medical center and possibly this one out.
Yeah, we have seen an ambulance come in from the outside to take the place of the one that's about to go out with the injured track worker. There is the new one.
This may be, I think, Bob, I'm not sure they're going to take one out. I think they're bringing this one in to go down to the hospital to pick up the injured corner worker, course worker.
In any case, that's why we are under this caution. It has nothing to do with what has happened on the racetrack in the last few laps, but because of the injury to the track worker earlier.
And we see pit road once again is still closed. There's no point in bringing these cars down pit road and getting all mixed up with that. So we're doing the wise thing, just circulating these cars around the racetrack at slow speed.
Coming up on 124 laps to go in the NAPA AutoCare 500. Top five are Bobby Labonte, Mike Skinner, Kenny Wallace, Jeff Gordon, and Jeffrey Bodine. Back in Martinsville, pit lane is now open. Bobby Labonte and everybody else behind him on the lead lap. Eligible to come in for a pit stop, here's John Kernan.
Bobby Labonte inching his way down pit road, just agonizingly slow, it seems, as he pulls into his pit. Four-tire change, no changes to the car at all. Bobby told Jimmy Makar, the car is really good. I don't know what we can do to it to make it any better. Right side works already completed. They swing around to the left side, down to Bill Weber.
An outstanding exchange between Gordon and Weitzel. Originally, Jeff said, don't do anything to the car, it's coming to me. Weitzel pointed out late in the race, the car has a tendency to free itself up. Should we put one round in the track bar? Jeff said yes. Then he said, no, let's make it a half round. A half round is what it is, the 24 racing the 18 to Jerry.
Mike Skinner, four tires, an air pressure change, a little bit too tight in the middle of the corner. Very congested down here in the pits. Skinner is down and away as others try to make their way back on the racetrack. This should have been the final scheduled stop of the afternoon.
And they had to wait until the field passed by, but Bobby Labonte, Jeff Gordon, Kenny Wallace, Mike Skinner, Kyle Petty, Jeffrey Bodine is the order in which they came out.
And the fact that they have a speed limit on pit road is the only which allows Martinsville to make one pit road. At 30 miles per hour, all that traffic, all those tires you have to dodge, that you're able to manage it. You can imagine what these guys would be doing wide open around here. They'd be running into someone each and every lap. So the pit road, therefore we have one pit road at Martinsville with the pit road speed.
Dale Jarrett pulls out while Mark Martin still gets service on the right side of his car. Rusty Wallace is in, so is Steve Park. Wallace completes his work. Ricky Rudd finishing up his work on the Tide Ride.
The Tide-Dye Tide Ride.
Yeah. Jeffrey Bodine comes in for a second time now. Jerry?
He came in a moment ago with the cars on the lead lap and changed four tires and made a slight air pressure adjustment. Now he will come back in to take care of the overheating problem. He said a moment ago, it is hot. We have lost some power in the engine, but the chassis feels very, very good. So we need to put some water in it. So he is coming back in the second time, trying to stay on the lead lap. Now he's two pits away, one pit away, and he will bring the power team machine to a stop. They'll raise the deck lid, looking at the overflow valve. They're going to check about putting some water in the front. So they have both the hood up and the rear up, making sure they get it full of water, completely full. They're checking in the overflow tank in the back, releasing some of the air. They bleed the air out of the system to allow more water to go in and displace the air that was there from the water that was lost. That's why they have both the front and rear lids up. They put them down now, and now Jim Long says, down and away.
Jeffrey moves back out onto the racetrack. He'll go back to seventh position, the last car on the lead lap. 120 to go, 380 complete at Martinsville Speedway in the NAPA AutoCare 500. We'll be right back. We'll be back to racing here in about another lap at Martinsville. Show you the Coke pit summary and how they now run on the racetrack compared with how they were before the pit stop. Bobby Luani stays the same. Mike Skinner loses two spots. Wallace the same. Gordon up two. And Jeffrey Bodine down two positions, dropping from fifth to seventh. Kyle Petty gained one spot. And so did Dale Earnhardt. Marlin stayed the same. Rusty lost one, and Jarrett moved up a position to ninth. Pace car is in, and we'll be getting the green flag here in just a moment to resume the competition on lap 384.
Ready. Green flag, green flag.
Get up there and catch Bobby Labonte and see if he can get back on the lead lap.
Now Kyle Petty's hung on the outside, and this hot wheels Bonnet just is not going on the outside of the racetrack. Now he just finally forces his way down to the curb where it seems like his car runs the best.
Hutch Strickland there is a lap down in 12th position. Jeremy Mayfield is in 18th, three laps down. Look at what happened to Kyle Petty a couple of laps ago that got him up in that outer lane and caused him to lose some track position.
You will see him come right behind Jimmy Spencer on the outside of Spencer. He comes off the corner and Spencer doesn't realize he's there. He goes up and just forces Kyle right in the outside retaining wall down the front stretch. And Earnhardt just barely gets on the inside of Kyle Petty and takes over. Right now Earnhardt is up to fourth spot. And evidently, Kyle Petty has got some suspension in the Hot Wheels Pontiac because it certainly isn't running nearly as well as it has been. Jeff Bodine up on the outside trying to get by Kyle.
That's the battle for sixth. Jerry, did they do everything they needed to do on that 60 car?
Bob spoke with Jim Long, who was pleading his case with NASCAR. He was watching very closely as they were putting water in the car. So they got it full of water, and the temperature seemed to come down. So hopefully that is the case. And they are watching very closely. And Jim Long has talked to the NASCAR officials who are also watching that car very closely. But right now, so far, so good for the power team efforts. And considering how well they've run, it would be a shame to see them have to park it for an overheating problem here in the final 100 laps.
Approaching those final 100 laps.
Different dives on the inside of Denny Schrader. Schrader several laps down. Four laps down.
Jerry has another report on Kyle Petty.
After bouncing off the wall about 10 laps ago, he had not said anything until just a moment ago when he yelled in the radio, "We need a caution bad. We need a caution bad," indicating to his team that obviously that right front has been damaged and he's got a handful of steering wheels. So as you can tell by the fact that the car is not running nearly as well as the Hot Wheels Pontiac had run earlier today. So the 44 team begging for a yellow flag, hoping to get one ASAP.
Just about 4 o'clock Eastern time, and for those of you just joining us, we are just a little more than 100 laps away from the
conclusion. There's only 7 cars on the lead lap with 105 to go.
Thank you. Good summary. 7 cars on the lead lap, 105 laps to go. On board with Mike Bliss, a graduate of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, and before that, a graduate of the ESPN Thunder Series when he ran the USAC Midgets and Sprints back in the Indiana area.
As a matter of fact, Mike Bliss will be in Louisville this Friday night for the truck race up there, so check it out, ESPN, 8 o'clock, Friday night.
Feeling old BP will be there too, huh?
Yes, I will.
Bill Elliott, 58 top tens during his short track career, including 2 victories. David Green is in the 45 car. He's 4 laps down in 26th position. Here comes the leader of the race, Bobby Labonte. Right now, he is the fastest car on the racetrack, or was last lap at a little more than 91 miles an hour.
He's the fastest of the lead lap cars. I think Jeff Burton might be the fastest car on the lead lap, I mean on the racetrack, because he's catching Bobby Labonte.
Now what's going on? What's going on with Mike Skinner? Remember how well he ran? Well, right now, these guys are just pulling away from him. As a matter of fact, Skinner is 7 seconds behind the leader, Bobby Labonte.
Normally, we show you how the interval is shrinking between a particular duo, but this time, we show you that the interval is widening between first and fifth. Jerry, what's the deal with Mike?
Well, the word is the car just absolutely will not turn. It's just plowing up across the racetrack. And when it won't turn on a track with 2 long straightaways and tight corners, it means you can't get back in that throttle. That's costing valuable time. You saw a moment ago, he's headed the wrong direction.
One thing that might have hurt him there for about 10 laps, the sun had gone behind the cloud and the track was shaded, cooled it down, and if you have a tight race car, that would make it even worse. Now the sun has come back out. Don't know if it'll help him or not. We'll see.
Caution's out. Caution's out.
Now the caution's out to let the ambulance back across the racetrack, I believe,
that came in to get the patient. And now they have him loaded up and we'll take him out.
That's just a guess. I believe the situation.
There is the ambulance that came in just a few laps ago, now has the patient and is about to exit Martinsville Speedway. We have not received a condition report on the individual or his name, but if we should get that information before we go off the air, we'll certainly pass it along to you.
Big Ben.
He'll exit the racetrack down in turn four.
Martinsville Speedway has no tunnel, so that's why the need for the caution flag to open the gate, crossover gate, before vehicle traffic goes across the speedway.
Of course, pit road is closed now as the ambulance makes its way out.
Less than 100 laps from the finish of this one, 96 to go. Going to see pit stops, guys?
No, we know Kyle needs one. This is a well-placed pit stop for Kyle Petty, but the rest of these guys, I don't know. What do you think, Dan?
I don't know either. They certainly have enough fuel to go the rest of the way, but we've seen that they get slower and slower as they run longer and longer. I believe we'll see them come in.
31 car obviously will be coming in, make some adjustments because he's going the wrong direction, so yeah. This could be very timely caution flag for several cars.
Pit road.
Now, so yep. We'll see. All that speculation will go right out the window one way or the other here. Bobby DeBond said, what are we going to do this time if I'm going to do it? No.
He tried to fake everybody. He didn't do a very good job.
Earnhardt's coming in. He didn't even think about it. He didn't waver. And the 31 and the 60. And Kyle Petty will be coming in as well. So the first three stay out. The next four come in.
Work being done on Dale Earnhardt's car, changing left side tires now. And a good pit stop for Earnhardt at 15.6 seconds.
Wow, we saw him working on that left front fender once again, trying to get that sheet metal away from the tire. Jerry Punch.
Larry McReynolds let Mike Skinner make the call. Said, there's only seven cars in the lead lap. You want to go ahead and risk coming in and try to make the car better? And Mike said, it's just plowing so bad. It's so tight. What do we have to lose? Let's come in and make an adjustment. They make a track bar adjustment on the right rear. Up two rounds, three quarters of a round. As he is in for four tires, Kyle Petty likewise in. As Mike Skinner is down and away, Kyle let that damage on the right front, and his car obviously wouldn't turn because of the bend on the right
fender
front.
Out. We're last car here anyway. Get that fender out.
Indicating they're trying to pull that right front fender away on the 44 car, the Hot Wheels car of Kyle Petty. They wanted to be able to make some adjustments in the front end, the left front fender, I should say, but they don't have time under a green cloud to stop. So decided to go ahead and let him go. As Dale Jarrett, our point leader, also on pit road.
Down in eighth position.
Sterling Marlin came in front of Jarrett. He's only taking on right side tires, Jarrett is. Sterling Marlin couldn't get in his pits, but he only took on right side tires, so he's going to come out behind Jarrett, so he's only going to lose one position. The four car of Bobby Hamilton, here we see Jarrett coming in the 40 car, so he has to stop right there as the four car was coming out, and right there is Sterling's pits, so he had to wait so he could turn left and go into the pits. That cost him some time. But he only changed right side tires, so he got back out. Didn't lose too much.
You receive Bobby Hamilton, the Kodak Film Napa Chevrolet, Napa onboard camera coming back in. Remember, he's had that damage to the left rear when John Andretti ran into him in turn three several laps ago.
And John Andretti is currently the only driver out of the race. 42 cars remain in competition.
This is a sport where the work of weeks and months is measured in hundredths of a second. This is a sport where glory and fortune can all come down to a gallon of gas. This is a sport where fans buy seats they never sit in, and they couldn't be happier about it. This is a sport that truly revolves around its fans. In fact, the drivers even go door to door to get the fans to come to the track. This is NASCAR.
Back at Martinsville, where the NAPA AutoCare 500 is about to get the green flag next time around. Bobby Labonte at the front of the field, Jeff Gordon second, then Kenny Wallace, Dale Earnhardt, Mike Skinner, Jeffrey Bodine, and Kyle Petty. Those seven cars are on the lead lap.
Okay, now we're going to check out the strategy. The first three cars stayed out, did not pit. The next four cars all stopped for four tires. What's going to be the best strategy? Get Bobby Labonte, Jeff Gordon, Kenny Wallace to make the right decision staying out.
Five, three wide, green flag.
Labonte let him down very, very slowly.
Jeff Burton was almost up to Bobby Labonte trying to get a lap back right before the caution came out. Now's his best opportunity to do it. He's got the inside preferred route. And Rusty Wallace is right there. Rusty is only one lap down. He is running in the eighth position, so he certainly would like to get up there in case there is another caution.
And Jeff Gordon was going to try to follow Rusty Wallace through. Can he? This would be a battle for the lead. Rusty's on the inside of Bobby Labonte.
A little bit of damage there on the back end of Jeff's car. He's dragging something.
Part of the plastic rear bumper. And Labonte getting squeezed down to the inside. No, Rusty Trouser down in that corner so deep, trying to keep that preferred position. Oh, banging down the back stretch.
Rusty is back on the lead lap.
And here comes Gordon
to battle Bobby Labonte for the lead. At the line, Labonte with a half a car length advantage, but Gordon runs her down into turn one. Meanwhile, Kenny Wallace is right there also in the 55 car. Bill Weber has a report on Jeff Gordon. He's looking good.
Bob, the fact they did not pit probably helped that team. The 24 car is clearly not the best car on new tires. When the caution came out, Gordon told crew chief Brian Weitzel, this car came to me a lot faster than it did before. They had talked about putting scuffs on if they pitted. They were going to put on stickers instead, but now a crash on the track.
And several cars.
Start finish. Caution's out.
Big break for Rusty Wallace and Jeff Burton. Jeff just got one of two laps back, but they race back to the line, and now they are back on the lead, or Rusty's back on the lead lap. Jeff Burton is only one lap down there.
Bickle, Nadeau, and Craven are the three cars that stop down here right at the start-finish line. Now all of them begin to move away.
With a lot of sheet metal damage done to many of them.
It's Jerry Nadeau's M&M's Pontiac. Damage on the back end of Craven's car. Here it is once again.
Well, Joe Nemechek also involved in that.
So is David Green and Kevin LePage. Mike Bliss, we're on board with him. He's going to have a scary ride.
Well, the Kenny Irvin through there right on the outside. No problem out there because the wreck was happening down on the low side of the racetrack as they all spun in that direction.
So another caution here. We ran so long without a caution. Now we've had three pretty close together. And just before the caution came out, it was Jeff Gordon who went into the lead. Kenny Wallace also was able to get around Bobby Labonte, and now he runs in second spot. Yeah. Here comes Gordon and Labonte, both pitting.
Wow.
Kenny Wallace stays out there.
Kyle Petty also coming in, down to John Kernan.
Bobby Labonte and his crew, after talking it over, have decided to come in and get four tires. Bobby also said, so I don't know if he was caught up in that because I was checking out something on Earnhardt back up in turns three and four, so I didn't see the incident. But Bobby said something about he thought he knocked the toe out just a little bit. So we'll have to wait and see how that affects the car. Left side tires going off now. Jeff Gordon is in his pit stall. Here's Bill Weber.
They were going to stay out, but they ended up playing follow the leader. So it is four tires for this team, four sticker tires. The 18's out of his pit stall. Left side's going on. Fuel's in. Rusty's away. Now Gordon's away. Even with the 18 as they head down pit road.
Ooh,
Rusty was just coming into his pits when Jeff Gordon and Bobby Labonte were going out, and it was very, very close there.
Here's Rusty Wallace's pit stop. They're changing tires on the left side now. Pulling the sheet metal away, and Rusty Wallace now on the lead lap goes back out there.
And when you talked about the possibility of the toe end being knocked out of alignment on Bobby Labonte's car, it could have been when he and Rusty Wallace got together on the backstretch over there. The wheels look like hit together, and boy, it doesn't take much like that sometimes to do a little damage.
So we add another car to those on the lead lap. There are now eight. Kenny Wallace did not pit during this caution. He's at the front of the field, and look who's up in second spot. Dale Earnhardt with Skinner, Jeffrey Podine, and Bobby Labonte completing the top five. So there is the leader, Kenny Wallace, who led 46 laps earlier. He's back in front of the NAPA AutoCare 500.
Cars lining up for the restart. Kenny Wallace for the leader. Jeremy Mayfield, car on the inside, a lap down.
Three laps down.
Two out of the last three races, we have had a first-time winner in NASCAR Winston Cup competition. Kenny Wallace has never won a race in this series. Jeremy Mayfield running there now beside Earnhardt is three laps down in 16th spot. So what's going through Kenny Wallace's mind right now, knowing that he could win a race, but look who he's got in his rearview mirror.
Exactly. Dale Earnhardt with much fresher tires than he has on.
Down to John Kernan.
I don't know if you guys remember this. I don't even remember the exact year, but it was in the late 80s that Kenny Wallace made his NASCAR Busch Series debut in the fall Busch Series race right here at the Martinsville Speedway. And guess which car he was in when he made that debut? The number three of Dale Earnhardt.
John, your memory's too good because I don't remember that. Earnhardt with those fresher tires right now seems to be faster than Kenny Wallace. Bill Weber?
Well, I talked to Wallace crew chief Jimmy Ellich, and he said they basically decided to stay out because their car is handling good and they really wanted that track position. They believe that the guys that have given up the front spot have had so much trouble getting it back that they wanted to take that chance. So they decided to stay out on older tires for track position to see how it works out.
Last time we had three time winners in the season was 94. They were Marlon, Gordon, and Spencer.
Right now, once again, Earnhardt, four red tires, much fresher than Kenny Wallace's. He's faster, and he's got trying to get that position. And here he comes.
Inside of Kenny Wallace, out of corner four at the line. They bump coming down the straightaway. Wallace hangs onto the lead for that lap. That was 4:30. Let's see what happens on this circuit.
Still pretty even over that turn. Wallace had that bike coming on the high side of the racetrack coming off that turn, so he's able to pull away. But Earnhardt right here is where he seems to be the best. Yep. He gets that traction coming off of there and blows right on by.
Earnhardt
takes the lead.
431st lap is led by Dale Earnhardt. And that is the first time today that Dale has led. He becomes our 11th different leader in this race. Here's a battle for position. For fourth, it is Bobby Labonte, Jeffrey Bodine, and Jeff Gordon all going for the same spot. Petty can be included in that group also.
Labonte clears. Jeffrey Bodine. Can Jeff Gordon do it? It doesn't look like it. No, he's not able to get on the inside of Jeffrey Bodine. Well, that was close.
Of holding off the challenge by Jeff Gordon. have a fender in position headed into turn one.
Does have the position. You get the traction off the turn, which it looks like he will, and takes it to position back.
Moving up to fifth. Now let's see what Kyle Petty will do with Jeffrey Bodine. There's the leader of the race, Dale Earnhardt. Now by almost a half second over Kenny Wallace. 436 out of 500 laps completed in the NAPA AutoCare 500. Welcome back to Martinsville. 442 laps completed. Again, we'd like to tip our hat to the Pennzoil Copter Cam, which has been providing us the overhead shots of this race all afternoon long. Just a beautiful day for racing here in the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia. Dale Earnhardt with a 6/10 of a second lead over Kenny Wallace. There's first and second. That third car there in your shot is Dale Jarrett, who is a lap down in ninth position. John Kernan has more on Dale Earnhardt looking for his third win of 1999. He hasn't done that since 95, John.
Bob, and what a come-from-behind win it would be for Earnhardt if he can hold on. Remember, under his first pit stop, they pitted under green, but just as they were on pit road, the caution came out. They lost a lap. They got the lap back. But that's not the only come-from-behind effort today. Earnhardt is suffering from the flu. He doesn't feel well, so during every pit stop, they've made sure that they've given him plenty of cold water to drink and also some cold towels. So what an effort if the Intimidator can hang on for the final, what, 55 laps?
Yep. And what makes this even more impressive is he started back in 38th position, the lowest start of a winner since 1953, if he goes on to win.
Looks like right now Jeff Gordon may be a little bit faster than Bobby Labonte, and it looks like Kyle Petty may be faster than both those cars.
I think you're right, Benny. He's passed a lot of cars coming up, and now he's got Rusty Wallace right on his tail, though, as they work through some traffic. Rusty, remember, got his lap back. He's in seventh, Kyle in sixth. And right there are the fourth and fifth place cars of Bobby Labonte and Jeff Gordon. Wallace.
Now lengthen the advantage to over a second.
1.15.
Earnhardt's worst finish on a short track this year, 19th at Martinsville. He's had four top 10 finishes, including, of course, the win at Bristol. 12 times he has started 26th or worse this year and has won one of them. Today again, he started in 38th position. Here comes another Hardy's Field summary with the point standings as of now. Mike Skinner making a big jump in the points, up two. Terry Labonte dropping one. Labonte 89 laps down, back in 40th position. Huge change in the points from 16 through 20.
Dale Jarrett right now has an awfully good race car. The Ford Qualifier number 88, the points leader, but unfortunately he's a lap down.
Yeah, he's really been battling Kenny Wallace hard to try to get by him, but he's got it beside him a couple of times, but Kenny trying to hold on to that position. Kenny knows as long as he's got DJ between he and Mike Skinner back there that's a buffer for him, and it'll make it harder for them to catch up to him.
With Rusty Wallace. We told you that in the 1990s, Rusty is the king of the short tracks, but in 1999, the best average finish on the five short track races that we have had, Dale Earnhardt with a win and an average finish of 8.8. Second is Rusty, followed by Martin. Stewart has an average finish of 10.2. But he, of course, ran into trouble early and is back in 41st spot, some 107 laps down. So can Dale Earnhardt continue on for the next 45 laps and win his third race of 1999? Well, we'll be back to answer that question and others when we return. Dale Earnhardt's lead over now Mike Skinner is more than 2.75 seconds as we click off lap number 462.
And you wonder what happened to Kenny Wallace, who was running in second place. He's been passed. He's back to fifth place now. I think the tires that he has on there has just gotten to him now. His tires are the oldest of any of those on the lead lap.
Here's a good three-car battle. Skinner, Bobby Labonte, and Jeff Gordon, second, third, and fourth.
Skinner stopped on lap 406 along with Earnhardt, Kyle Petty, and Jeffrey Bodine. And then the 18 car of Bobby Labonte and Jeff Gordon stopped on lap 419. So the 18 and 24 have the fresher tires, although the 31 only has about 10 more laps than they do. And we see Skinner diving down to the inside of Rick Mast.
Rick has had a tough day today in that 98 car. He's nine laps down in 32nd position. Qualified good, but just never could get her hooked up.
We got three cars off the track. Robert Presley, Joe Nemechek, and Rich Bickle. And only one car officially listed as out of the race. That's John Andretti, who went from winner in the spring to finishing last in the fall. Earnhardt just continues to put distance between himself and everybody else. That advantage up now to more than 3.75 seconds. And Bobby Labonte taking a look to the inside of Mike Skinner from the Pennzoil Copter Cam. He may have Skinner here.
Hard to get that traction down on the inside when your line is taken away. You can't enter the turn like you normally would if you were running by yourself when you're down on the inside of another car. But Bobby Labonte did fight him at the line, and he'll fight him going into turn.
And Skinner slipped in between Jeff Gordon and Bobby Labonte. So that Jeff Gordon's going to have to work to try to get by the low Chevrolet.
Who is lapping slower traffic. There's a Elliott Sadler that he puts another lap on. Elliott is now six laps down in 27th position. Jeff Gordon now to the inside of Mike Skinner and taking over third.
And you can see that Jeff Gordon gets such good traction off the corner. Looks like that poor Skinner is struggling right now, just getting that traction off the corner. Look at their leader, Earnhardt, in a lot of traffic as he goes by Bobby Hamilton. There's Terry Labonte, and I'm sure Bobby Labonte sure hoping this stuff gets sorted out before he gets there.
He knows that he has to go through it too, but he hopes it's in single file when he gets to it.
Well, Earnhardt's gone through pretty quickly.
Yes, he has. Very quickly. If he didn't go to the outside, he did that. If he didn't go to the inside, he did that. His car just working wherever he needs for it to go.
Joe Nemechek has been off track. He goes back into the competition. And you can see the huge number of cars between Earnhardt now and Bobby Labonte. And Bobby has got to weave his way through all that mess up there. He's only got 28 laps before the checkered flag drops.
Nine cars to pass.
Oh, there's a spin right in front of these guys.
There are the top five.
Whoop
the spin
off.
Involves.
Whoop off. There you go, buddy. Caution is out. Good job, bud.
One of the guys did some nice evasive maneuvers by going inside or outside of Chad Little, and they missed him. Here comes Dale to the checkered flag. He'll take it on the conclusion of lap 474.
Now then, I mean, these cars are going to make pit stops.
Actually, Kenny Wallace will, because he's back to six now and only eight cars on the lead lap, and his car was fading. So I think you definitely pay him to make
seconds hit stop.
Pit road right now is closed. We saw the, is it going to be open now? No, it's still closed.
Take a look at what happened to Chad Little coming off of corner number four.
Well, he was in that big mess of traffic that we were talking about. Looks like he got a little bump from it. Didn't know what that car was, a red car.
Looks like Ricky Craven. Yes, it was. Yep. Ricky Craven,
car number 50.
Now watch these cars go by on the bottom of the racetrack.
Ooh, Kenny Wallace just squeezed by.
Watch, here comes Jeremy Mayfield. Watch, now watch Jimmy Spencer.
Yeah.
Let's try this going in the third corner. There's all that group of cars we were talking about. And there we see the 50 car just in the very left corner of the screen make contact with 97. And around Chad Little goes. And he'll come back across the racetrack. Now watch these guys that go by on the inside. Jeffrey Bodine, Terry Labonte. Here comes the 12 car. Watch Jimmy Spencer.
No! Earnhardt Sand, here's John.
In fact, Bob, just about everybody on the lead laps coming down pit road right now. Earnhardt's crew already changing the left side tires. Nice, smooth stop. Earnhardt's down the way, no adjustments.
Look at that, 15.2. Wow.
Bobby Labonte also in for a change of rubber. Just right sides?
Just right sides. He pulls out in front of Dale Earnhardt as Earnhardt comes down. 55 is in, but he'll probably get four, don't know. Yes, he will.
And the 31 is in, Doc.
Mike Skinner plans on getting four tires, 1.5 rounds in the track bar. He said the car was so loose coming off he couldn't drive it. He had nothing to lose. They're going to make a significant adjustment. Four tires, and Skinner is down and away.
And Jeff Gordon stayed on the racetrack. Already Brian Weitzel has made a huge decision. Bill Weber.
And they talked it over, and they basically decided it was too much track position to give up. They wanted the opportunity to get up front. They did it. They think their car is good on the tires they have on there now. They had scuffs on the wall. Even when Earnhardt came down, Jeff made the decision not to follow him down pit road.
Will it be the right decision? Dale Jarrett is in for a pit stop now.
He was the first car on the lead lap. Made a 15.9 second pit stop. A good pit stop to take on four tires. He can get back out to be the first one on the long lead lap, run lap down.
So as we go back to green now in a few moments, it'll be Jeff Gordon, Bobby Labonte, Dale Earnhardt, Jeffrey Bodine, and Mike Skinner. And Bobby Labonte dodged a bullet as he drove through the wreck that has caused this most recent caution here at Martinsville when Chad Little got hit by Ricky Craven and spun into the inside wall. We'll resume and have the final laps of the NAPA AutoCare 500 in a moment. There are 20 laps to go. They've been given the signal green next time by, so we should have 19 laps of racing to decide who wins the NAPA AutoCare 500. That's only about 7 minutes of competition, so don't go anywhere. Jeff Gordon is in the lead. Can he win his very first race without Ray Evernham under the direction of Brian Weitzel?
That was a gutsy call Brian and Jeff made to stay out there. They have no tires, fresh tires. Bobby Labonte in second has two. Dale Earnhardt third has four fresh tires.
Ready. Green flag. Green flag.
Gordon gets a huge break when he gets by the lap traffic. He hangs Labonte up on the outside. That'll get him an advantage of about a second or so.
Down to John Kernan.
Bobby Labonte just radioed in to his crew chief Jimmy Mekar and said the motor's blowing up. The motor's blowing up. So keep an eye on the 18 car.
Oh. Well, he has got a jammed up mess behind of him because the car won't go that well. Ricky Craven just got by.
And Earnhardt dives to the inside and takes over the second spot.
Meanwhile, Jeff Gordon has taken about a 1.1 second advantage. Skinner has a flat, Jerry.
Indeed, he just radioed. He thinks he's got a flat right front tire. The car would not turn. The crew just up on the wall has tires waiting. We'll see if Mike will indeed come on the pit road.
All kinds of things happening here in the last 20 laps of the race. There are 16 to go at Martinsville. And Labonte continues to fall back.
And Kyle Petty's car is smoking heavily. Great run he's been having all day, and it looks like it's going down the tubes.
Down to Jerry again.
Kyle reported a left front tire rubbing on the 44 car. That's a smoke that apparently are seeing from that car. A left front tire rubbing. Everyone's just going full bore here in the final lap. What a shootout.
Boy, Ricky Rudd and Kenny Wallace got together coming off the turn two. Almost wrecked. Both of them did a great job of not wrecking.
There is Kyle Petty back in the eighth spot.
There we see the smoke off the left front tire.
Gordon with a 1.16 second advantage last time by. We'll see what it is when he crosses the line this time. It is 1.09. Earnhardt gained a bit.
He has Hutch Strickland between himself and Jeff Gordon. Now, how quickly is Hutch Strickland going to get out of the way? That's going to be the key. Bill Weber.
Remember, throughout the day, Jeff Gordon's car has not been good on new tires. That's why they opted not to put any on. So he's on older tires. The longer he runs, the more the car comes to him. He's got 12 laps to see how far it comes to him in this race.
Boy, Earnhardt getting anxious, put a little bit of a bumper to Hutch Strickland there. That's the first car a lap down. Now it goes a little higher. Earnhardt will try to dip under him.
Checking the intervals, it's still 1.02 seconds. Fastest car among those on the lead lap appear to be Kenny Wallace.
But now Dale Earnhardt is going to have 10 laps to chase down Jeff Gordon. And there's a distance he's got to go. I believe he can make it, Bob.
This is going to be interesting. Oh, he closed her down that time to 83 hundredths.
0.2 seconds.
Look how consistent Dale Earnhardt has been in the last four laps, BP.
You see in traffic that 21.1. All the other laps, 20.8. Leading Jeff Gordon about a tenth each and every lap. That time by, the interval stayed the same at 0.8 seconds. Another lap.
And the interval stays just about the same at 86 hundredths of a second. Gordon has finished seventh or better, including two wins in the last nine races here. He finished third in the spring. He finished second a year ago. But look at that interval.
And he is just hugging that yellow, that curve all the way around the corner. That time Earnhardt gained a tenth.
And there are just seven more laps to go.
On the racetrack, and not a tough break. Earnhardt got that time because he had to pass Chad Little on the outside. That should help Jeff Gordon. It did not.
It did.
Yep. Still knocked a little bit of time off. Whoa, look at this. Just two or three car lengths now separating Gordon and Earnhardt.
Yep. Five laps to go when they return.
And Dave Marcus, a slower car up there in front of Jeff Gordon.
Brian Weitzel in command for the first time in the Jeff Gordon, Rick Hendrick operation. And Earnhardt has to pass Dave Marcus on the outside. That may have slowed him just a little.
A half second behind that last time. Come off the corner, going to be four laps to go this time.
496 completed. He lost just a little bit. It went from a half second to 0.59. But look at the fans. They're choosing their favorite. Coming down with just three laps to go. Gordon and Earnhardt. Jeffrey Bodine, Rusty Wallace, and Kenny Wallace are the top five. There's Brooke Gordon.
And that's Rick from Sprint's down in turn two.
Oh, will there be a caution? He spun all the way around and is moving.
He's headed in the right direction.
No caution yet. Two laps to go. Two to go for Jeff Gordon.
That's too bad for Hus Strickland. He had a great run going.
He did. Dale Jarrett just got by. And Hood went in the turn there and just lost the back end on it. He's moving again now, but he's lost a couple of laps.
Car is moving. Here's the white flag for Jeff Gordon. Gordon takes the white, separated by 42 hundredths of a second. Just one more lap around this half mile at Martinsville. And Jeff Gordon still maintains the lead as they go halfway down the backstretch. Traffic will not be a factor in this one. Here is Gordon off the corner, but Earnhardt is right behind him. No, it's Jeff Gordon winning the NAPA AutoCare 500 at Martinsville. Ray Evernham's departure did not end the dynasty. We are perhaps seeing the beginning of another reign here as Brian Weitzel leads his driver, Jeff Gordon, to victory in their first togetherness. Bill.
Well, you cannot imagine the emotion here in the DuPont pit. Gordon telling them on the radio, I'm so proud of you guys. You are awesome. That's Brian Weitzel being hoisted onto the shoulders of his fellow crewmen. High fives for this entire crew. And a dramatic win. And they may carry him all the way to victory lane. Brian, congratulations. A win in your first race as crew chief. How do you feel?
I feel great. I am so happy for these guys. This ain't about me. It's about this team. It's about Jeff Gordon, Rick Hendrick. We all stepped up. We got the job done. Ray Evernham taught us well. He is the reason we're here, ain't no doubt about it. But we are very thankful for what Rick and everyone else has done for us. Unbelievable. We knew we could do it, applied ourselves, and we got it done.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
A gutsy call and a dramatic win for Jeff Gordon.
It's his sixth win of 1999, the most of all drivers. 48 wins in his career. It ties him with Herb Thomas for 11th on the all-time win list. He's just one behind 10th place, Rusty Wallace.
Back at Martinsville Speedway, Jeff Gordon celebrates in victory lane. What an effort. The 49th or 48th NAPA AutoCare 500 is history. And what an effort by the Rainbow Warriors and brand new crew chief. There's Brian Weitzel. Jeff said, where's my new crew chief? Oh, he's going to get the shower, going to get the water, going to get the Pepsi, and going to get the hug. What an effort. He talked about the pressure and the pride. Jeff going to give Brooke a big hug and a kiss. She was crying when she came in. Jeff had tears in his eyes. A big handshake from John Hendrick. Congratulations, my friend. What a day.
I just want to thank God. There's no way that this was possible without God. And it wasn't possible without Ray Evernham, too. I mean, he's the one that orchestrated these guys. And that's the reason why we have this awesome race team. Man, so proud of these guys. Brian Weitzel led these guys this weekend like he was a veteran, and just so proud to have these guys on board. And I just can't say enough. We never gave up, refused to lose. That's always been our motto, and that was certainly it today. Man, I've never wanted to win so bad in my life. I saw that black three on my bumper, and I knew it was going to be real close. And you know, I didn't know if I could get them. Tires are pretty old, but great call in the pits by Brian. And you'd have never known it was his first race. But I want to thank DuPont Automotive Finishes and Quaker State, GMAC, Pepsi, this Chevrolet, and these Goodyear tires were really awesome today also. And I also want to thank Advance Auto Parts, Kellogg's. We got a lot of sponsors, but we sure do appreciate them.
Jeff Gordon is overcome with emotion, as I've seen him in a long, long time. When the car came in, he had tears in his eyes because of so much emotion, a sigh of relief. They remember what Ray Evernham has done for them over the years, the championships and the devotion. And now the Brian Weitzel era will begin with a victory at Martinsville Speedway.
Pepsi presents a Jeff Gordon moment. The date was April 20th, 1997, and the place was Martinsville, Virginia. Starting from the fourth position, it took Jeff Gordon just 22 laps to show that this was his day to dominate NASCAR Winston Cup racing. Gordon led a whopping 429 of the 500 laps that day to earn his 18th trip to victory lane.
Listen, I got it right here, buddy. It's icy cold and tasting great. Now, come on, Jeff, you tell me. Is there anybody in this world who deserves this here Pepsi more than you?
Hi, Jeff.
See you later, Jeff.
Coverage of the NAPA AutoCare 500 from Martinsville Speedway being brought to you by Pepsi, the official soft drink of Martinsville Speedway. By the more than 2,700 AutoZone stores across America, AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. And by the Wide Track Grand Prix by Pontiac, wider is better. The official margin of victory, 0.2 seconds, Jeff Gordon over Dale Earnhardt. We had a total, as far as leaders are concerned here this afternoon, of 11 different leaders and 17 lead changes, with Mike Skinner leading the most laps.
Mike Skinner had a great race car here today. See, Ted Musgrave led the first three or four laps on the outside, and he'll finish 19th today.
You see, Mark Martin came home, finished 16th there after having an unscheduled pit stop.
Just two drivers out of the race when the checkered flag dropped. As far as the points are concerned, it's a 251-point margin now that Dale Jarrett enjoys over Bobby Labonte, who moves into second in the point standing. Let's talk with Dale Earnhardt.
Dale Earnhardt, a second-place finish. Not feeling too well, but how do you feel now?
Still feel bad. I got to hand it to the guys. They worked awful hard on this car, and Jim Goodwin and Chevrolet run pretty good all day. I got a lap down by pitting too soon, and had to work back from that, got it back, and then we took the lead and raced them a while, and didn't need that last caution, but, the brakes don't always go your way, and I still think it would have been all right, but the 18 car blew up or something, lost the cylinder or something, and holding us up pretty bad there, and then finally got around and we just run out of time to run Gordon down, but we gave it our all. The guys did a great job. I got to, like you say, the engine and everything worked good, and just proves Gordon win no matter who's crew chiefing, huh?
Back upstairs.
Well, Dale Earnhardt will be the king of the short tracks overall in 1999 with his second place finish to Jeff Gordon here this afternoon. We'll wrap it up in a moment.
You know, my first racing days were pretty rough. With my wheels set so close together, I was always getting loose in the turns. Now that I'm trading paint with the big boys, wider is better.
With speed-sensitive steering, the Wide Track Grand Prix delivers precise control in the corners. No wonder it's been selected official pace car of NASCAR.
There's no getting around it. Wider.
The Wide Track Grand Prix. Wider is better. By Pontiac.
Ryan Weitzel leads Jeff Gordon to victory here at Martinsville. PGA Buick Challenge is coming up next from Martinsville, Virginia. So long, everyone.